young boys, bikers, riding, clown gang, angry, fighting, racing through the crowded streets, that's what I like. Into a wrinkly kid, blew up my bike. Canada and tattoo,
tattoo.
There's lots of shouts and they do. Canada and tattoo,
Canada.
They've known each other for a long time since school.
Tattoo.
Superpowers make it queasy. I know in my mind. Canada and tattoo, it's all over for you.
Canada!
Canada!
Tattoo!
Canada!
Tattoo! In Canada! Tattoo! Tattoo!
Canada!
Tattoo!
Lasers burnt off your arm. In a spooky nursery, the children will play. Now they are just wrinkly freaks who blow you away. No more joy for tattoo. He's only got one arm, not two. Lots of shit he's been through. Neo Tokyo is so fucked, it's true. He's turning into a big baby right now, and he will explode. Canada and tattoo, it's all over for you.
Don't
get the ending, how about you? It's confusing through and through. I checked the wiki, there's no clue. Just how much cocaine will I have to do? I'm sure they're making it up as they go. I think that's the truth. Now the credits are rolled, my mind's boggling too.
Hello and welcome to the Blackdog 164.
Oh,
ah. Canada!
Tatsuo! Or the American version, Tetsuo!
Canada! Anyway, hello, I'm Lee.
And I'm Darren.
And we are sponsored today by Peroni. Yes, cold, yeah. Ice cold Peroni beers.
The choice of a new generation.
So, yes, if we get more and more progressively drunk throughout this evening, please don't call the police when I drive Darren home.
Sorry, I've just got this image of you. So, like, from a point of view of standing on a hill watching you drive away, it just carries on. And he hits the fucking privet at the bottom. He just hit.
Oh, God. It's just a... over the bush. Right. Yeah, we're off to a good start. You just broke your tooth on the glass.
I went to put a thing in my mouth and it tapped my tooth. So there you go.
Can you tell it's going to be a long evening? Yeah. Anyway, so this week we will be doing a little bit of chat. Lots of news. Because as mentioned the week before, you know, Comic-Con has been happened. And so there is probably enough stuff there for us to talk about forever. By the way, if anybody hears any weird sounds in the background, that is because we got all the windows open and back door open as well. So if you hear the next door neighbours whooping it up or something, then I apologise. But we are not actually mob handed. We don't have an audience or the police. So anyway, there you go. So before we get on with all that, we've also got a shitty superhero. I think we've got Jimmy Moon's Profanasaurus. And then we go and review Akira.
Yes.
Which I know a lot of people are very happy about.
Yeah, they've been ecstatic.
According to the Facebook group. Yeah, they've been all over it.
They could not contain themselves. It was all like, you know, excitement of Tetsu proportions.
It was gargantuanly exciting for lots of people. I'm just going to keep drinking beer. Do you tell me about your week? How's your week?
My week. Let's see. Still lots and lots and lots of work. Can't seem to get away from this project now. It's going over its 3 week, or what I thought was a 3 week period. It's going well into the future now. So who knows when I'll be off of that. But yes, this weekend. Just gone. No, exactly. No, sorry. Monday. I would be giving you a review of World's End.
Well, I would have been on Friday, but some cunt asked me to go to the pub with them.
Oh, yeah, I know. Herc. God blimey. But yeah, I would have gone and see World's End. But Cineworld decided against it and decided to have all their fucking equipment break down.
Yes. God bless digital projectors.
Oh, yeah, it's wonderful. I'm sitting there all of a sudden, right? It gives us no warning that the film's about to start. I'm on the phone just trying to write something on Facebook.
And you're writing on your phone?
No, but there's no film playing. Normally, when I get a warning it's coming on, that's it. The fucking thing goes off and I turn it off and that's it. It goes in the pocket, right? So I'm like everyone else. We're sitting there just waiting for this fucking thing to begin. All of a sudden, the screen just kicks into life. There's no sound or anything. I'm sitting there, I'm thinking, okay, in any minute now, it's going to kick in really loudly. Any minute now. Any minute now. Any minute now. And it just didn't. Right. I had to run out to find the bloke to tell him that Screen 7 was, kaput.
Yeah.
And so, luckily, we had a good-natured crowd behind us who were kind of just all in with the joke.
Yeah.
Who were sort of like making various comments and sort of like trying to put their own sort of like backing track to some of the trailers that were coming up as there was no sound on it.
Right.
But finally, they got the sound on and then it went off again. And then it went on and then it went off again.
Right. I'm sensing a pattern here.
Yeah. Bloke wheels himself on and says, we're having a bit of technical difficulty. And it's like, no shit, Sherlock.
Yeah.
It'll be a couple of minutes. We'll get it fixed and, you know, everything will be fine and dandy. And so he trundles off, sound comes on, and then all of a sudden the sound and the picture go off and we're all sitting there in just pitch blackness. Everybody burst out laughing.
Yeah.
And it is like after a while he's come back in to tell us that the whole thing's broken down and that's it, they won't be showing the film tonight at that time. But they can give us tickets to another showing. Right? And there's a bloke, as he's doing this, this other bloke just walked in, stood beside him going, and you're going to give us a refund as well, aren't you? Like, no refund. And so, I mean, you know, me and Laura didn't actually pay really anything for the film, but it's like, had it, you know, we wouldn't have normally just gone out and bought a meal and then gone home. We would have just sort of like gone home and had the food that was already in the fridge. We spent money thinking we were having an evening out. And it's like a wasted opportunity, right?
Wow.
So yeah. I'm thinking, you know, maybe we'll get like a 50% discount thing on maybe one of the, you know, the restaurants.
Yeah.
And it's like, no, nothing.
No.
And he's trying to, it's like the way the manager started speaking to us, it's as if we're second class citizens because, you know, we're cheapskates because we bought a pass, like for the 15 quid a month pass to go and see as many movies as we like.
Right.
And it's like people who bought a ticket are getting another ticket to go and see the film another time. But for us, who are like, you know, we've come out for our one night out.
Hmm.
And that's it. It's been spoilt now because their equipment that they maintain in their fucking cinema.
Hmm. So didn't you, given that you've got the pass that allows you to see as many films as you like, didn't you just go to another screen?
No, it would have been too late. Because what it was, we were going to go for the 6:30, but then it's like Laura's like, well, should we go for a little bit later and go for a meal?
Mm.
I'm like, fine, yeah, we'll do that. Go for the 7:40. Yeah. And that was when it all fell apart. And yeah, so it's like we couldn't go to the later one. Yeah, it will. So, you know, the next show was something like 9:40.
Right.
And the actual manager came out with a classic. He goes, we're not even supposed to be giving out tickets to people. And it's like, so you're telling me that normally, if it breaks down, it's like, fuck you, Jack, you're on your own.
Yeah.
So, he's cheers for that, Cineworld.
I think he's trying to make it sound more important than he is. I mean, that wouldn't... Yeah. You stand in front of 500 people, say, our equipment's broke, and you're not getting anything back for it. Yeah, that would have gone down very well.
I think you would have seen the good humour evaporating people pretty fucking quickly.
Especially at the O2, I mean, sitting in the heart of lovely Greenwich... Which is bordered by three of the nastiest boroughs in the world.
Exactly. You know, and there were a few dodgy individuals.
Chelten, Thamesmead, Woolwich.
Exactly. So there you go. So we are going to go and see it on Sunday, but we may even just go to Bexley Heath and watch it there. So, you know.
Cool.
There you go.
Anything else?
Anything else? Went out for a drink on Saturday with a few friends, Martin, Leslie, Christian, Jessel.
Oh, yes.
Jen and also Marty as well. You know, all had a pretty good time that night.
That was good. Then I saw photos of you lot drinking cider out of buckets or something.
Well, they were. I must admit, it took my mood a while to get back on track because I was Mr. Apathy that night.
Yeah.
And that was probably the wrong time for me to read anything from Comic-Con
at
that time.
Well, we'll get to Comic-Con in a minute, because I think that's going to be the major section of this podcast.
It is. It's just going to be Comic-Con, that's it. But what about you, Lee? What have you done this week?
Well, this week what have I done this week? Oh, yeah, Carol signed me up for something for my birthday.
Oh, that's never good. Never good. Never start a conversation with, Carol signed me up for...
Yeah, for my birthday.
Yeah.
You might have seen it on Facebook, but for those who haven't...
Pilates?
No. Water jetpack. Yes, man.
Oh, my God. You are courting disaster.
I am going to be strapped to 7,000 pounds worth of water pressure thrust.
Oh, boy.
And fired over the Thames under my own control.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm doing that, man. So I'm doing that, I think on the 11th of August, I think I'm doing that.
Yeah, pictures or it didn't happen.
Yeah, it will. She wants to take photographs.
I want video as well. We all want to see video of you going...
Well, actually, funny enough, a couple of the guys from the course were saying that there'd be some really good footage to be taken from that. Because I'd be going up in the air and all this sort of thing. And so one guy actually is going to give me... I think he's going to give me his GoPro, waterproof GoPro. And I'm going to put it on my helmet.
Oh, you've got to, because it's the moment when suddenly the water runs out unexpectedly. See the sea suddenly coming up.
rush up to meet me. Yeah, so I'm doing it down by the Docklands. So I'm going to be doing it over the Thames. Yeah, so I get a half hour training on this thing.
It's me and Laura queued up for tickets at the O2 all of a sudden. We're
just see me go up over the top of the dome.
Yes.
I can see my house from here.
So
there you go. So that's all done. I've signed up for that. I broke the back of my project, so to speak. So that's quite good. I'm feeling good about that. I have something more to show. If anyone's following me on Facebook, they'll see slowly but surely updates start appearing. What else? Oh, watched Return of the Jedi with Katie, and we have now completed
the original trilogy. I saw the list of her enlisted in favourite order.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'm kind of not surprised by that list.
Do you know the worst bit, though?
Go on, then.
Return of the Jedi jumped to number 2.
Did it?
Do you know why?
Why?
Ewoks.
Oh, well, there you go. Fluffy.
Yeah. It was, she didn't stop laughing. She literally did not stop laughing for about 20 minutes for that, in that whole end fight. I'm sitting there, my teeth are turning to powder, and she's like giggling away like a lunatic. And she didn't stop laughing. And I'll tell you what, you know the biggest laugh she got?
Go on.
Okay. Well, firstly, there was the one where the Ewok gets the bolas in the face.
Yeah.
Then she really pissed herself. But the one that really got her was the one where the two Ewoks are running through the forest and the AT-AT basically shoots one up the arse and kills it. She was like beside herself in tears of laughter. So I'd like to think that it was a minor victory on my part. But yeah, so now it turns out her favourite is Star Wars. Her second favourite is Return of the Jedi. Third is Revenge of the Sith. Fourth is Empire, and fifth is Phantom Menace. She hasn't seen Attack of the Clones.
She hasn't?
No.
I wonder
however,
what she'll make of
I'm
that.
Really quite worried, because if that comes anywhere above fifth, I'm going to be... I'm already distraught at the fact that Empire is so low, but, you know...
Well, as she gets older, she'll change that point of view.
I really hope so, because I'd hate to disown my child at such a late stage of
life. I think, being the age she is, she's just going to go for, you know... I mean, that's it. It's all new, so it doesn't really matter. She hasn't got the baggage we've got, you know.
Yeah.
So, you know, oh, to view these things through the eyes of a child, you know.
Yeah. But anyway, she still likes Indiana Jones' Last Crusade, though. So that's the
point. Does she?
Yeah, we like
fabulous.
That. That's good.
That's
anyway,
good.
Anyway, so we did that. What else did I do? Oh, yeah. I told you this story, didn't I, in the pub. I said I was going to tell you this story. Do you know how long it takes to turn off a computer in my house?
How long does it take to turn off a computer in your house, Lee?
About 4 hours.
Does it?
Yes.
Why does it take 4 hours to turn a computer off in your house?
Let me tell you a story. Right, I obviously have two kids and a really quite warm house at this point, isn't it?
Yes, it is, yeah.
And I also have one remaining elderly cat.
Yes, you do.
Who's currently snoring away on our table. Yes?
Mm-hmm.
Right, okay. So, I've been working like an absolute bastard on this second camera tracking project.
Mm-hmm.
And then I decide, you know what? My concentration's failing. I can't actually concentrate. I cannot... You know, every time I click on Maya, my brain just kind of goes, no, and drags me off. So I'm right, okay, fine. You know what? I'm actually going to go to bed early. I'm going to go to bed at midnight.
Wow.
Right. So I decide I'm going to stop, right? Actually, it's not going to take 4 hours to turn it off. I remember it's 2.5, sorry. So, I go to turn the computer off. Then suddenly upstairs, I hear, Daddy. So that's like Katie wants to go to the toilet, whatever. Right, fine. So I go back upstairs.
Yeah.
Take her to the toilet. Come back to downstairs. Go to turn the computer off. As I do that, the cat goes... I'm like, no, don't throw up all over the kids' toys. Oh, fuck. So I'm then cleaning all the cat sick up. Right, okay, fine. Clearing it all up, throwing all that shit in the toilet. Get ready to flush. As I go to flush, Daddy. It's the other one now. Right, okay, so I go back upstairs, take her to the toilet, come back downstairs. Right, I'm going to flush the toilet. As I do that, oh yeah. In the kitchen. Cat's taking a shit in the kitchen. So I'm like, oh, fuck, I can't turn the computer off. So I go back out, big old curly turd in the middle of the fucking kitchen. Like, oh, right, okay. Clean that up, throw that in the toilet, go to flush the toilet. I'm going to go turn the computer off because then I can throw some bleach down and go to bed. Go to turn the computer off, go to touch, Daddy! It's the other one again. I'm hot. Go upstairs. Right, fine. Deal with that. Come back downstairs. Cat sitting on the table beside the computer. It's like, fuck, no. Take the cat. Run back outside. Throw the cat outside. Everywhere. Oh, God. So there I am in the garden at fucking now. It must be 1 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah.
Cleaning cat puke off the stone floor.
Lovely.
Right, okay. So I'm going to do that. Right, fine. Come back in. Go to turn the computer off. Daddy! Come from upstairs. This time, the other one again. I'm hot. My tummy's hurting. Right, okay. Go upstairs. Take care of her. Come back downstairs. The cat is taking a shit on the seat.
What seat? What?
That seat.
That seat?
That seat.
I'm glad you said that seat.
Not the one you're sitting
on. Not the one I'm sitting on, no.
every time I went to turn the computer off, either the cat would throw up, shit, throw a hairball somewhere, or take a dump in the middle of the fucking living room or something, and the kids would wake up 5 minutes later. I literally, on deciding I wanted to go to bed, took 2 hours to turn that fucking computer off.
And you got an awful lot done.
I felt my fingers covered in shit. The whole house smelled of piss and
wonderful.
Shit. Everything. There you go. That's as interesting as my life gets at the moment. Cat's piss. Cat's piss.
It's all shit, oh, yeah. Piss and puke.
Exactly. Oh, yeah, I forgot the cat did actually piss on the doormat as well.
Hey!
And I had to take the doormat and throw that in the washing machine.
There's just no saving this.
No. So that furry bundle of arse over there is actually... She's right there. She's,
yep.
Yeah. Just caused me all sorts of grief. So by the time I got up next morning, my eyes are like piss holes in the snow. I walked into...
Did you have to get up?
I had to get up about six.
Six, right.
Yeah. So by the time I get back to the Escape Studios, they're all looking at me going, oh, you've been up doing work? And I'm like, no, I haven't done any fucking work. I fucking stopped doing work at midnight.
No, I have a family and a cat.
A cat. A belligerent shit
bastard bloody thing.
Fucking thing. Anyway,
bloody bastard.
So if anyone has any advice on what to do for a cat that just wants to piss absolutely everywhere, please send it into the Black Dog at Black Dog at Geek Planet Online, please. Other than that, I sent in some artwork to Matt Dillon because he's got a print page. He's got a page on a magazine.
Yes, he has, hasn't he?
Geek Planet Online.
Yes, very sort of pulp fiction type. Yeah.
So he's done a very good thing. Apart from that, that's it. I've really not a lot else to say. I mean, it says a lot when basically going to the pub and clearing up cat shit is essentially my entire life.
Well, it's just about in line with the major news this week, isn't it? Like a woman has had a baby. So there you go. News. No, I'll say that until we actually get to the news section.
Fucking.
But anyway, yes.
Okay.
Let's do some news. Come on.
Let's do some news.
Hey, we're gonna hear some news now.
Right, okay, news. Well, what we'll do is we could cover all the Comic-Con stuff. We'll cover bits of it, I think.
Highlights,
shall we say. But let's start with stuff that's post-Comic-Con.
Okay, I was going to say, because I've got something that's not post-Comic-Con.
Okay, well, you start with something then. Go on, go for it. What have you got?
We have, of course, the sad news that somebody... whose name is a part of our show.
Synonymous with our cast.
Synonymous with our cast.
Not that
he would
have appreciated it, I don't think.
I don't know. I think you would have found a bit of humour in there.
Yeah.
As sadly passed away. We are talking, of course, about the comedian, actor, director, writer, Mel Smith.
Yes.
Who we use for the Mel Smith moment of the week.
Yes, Mel Smith. Yeah, Mel Smith moment of the week. Yeah, Mel Smith, who died age 60 of a heart attack.
Oh, no.
On Saturday, which I don't know what the date is now because I don't know when you'll be listening to it, but trust me, he died on the Saturday.
It's strange to actually think that, these days it's like 60 is such a young age.
Yes, he did have problems with addiction to painkillers. He had a problem with, he had a stroke and several other problems before his death, so I wouldn't like to say, be flippant and say that it was expected, but it's certainly, I think when you listen to what he was going through at the time, I don't think it was unexpected.
No.
Mel Smith was, of course, really one of our influences with Alas Smith and Jones and Not 9 o'clock News.
He was, wasn't he?
Bloody hell, the Mel and Griff talking heads thing is pretty much what we're fucking doing right now, isn't it?
Do you know, one of the ones that I remember most of all is you've got him and Griff Rhys Jones sitting there talking to each other, and he goes, oh, yeah, Meryl Streep, he said, I really like her. So he says, oh, yeah, 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 yeah. I look at it, she's like, I was watching her in this film the other night.
She's a consummate actress. She looks lovely. She sounds great. And I thought to myself, God, I'd have to fuck her in the arse.
I like the news report about with the 1066 Herald would like to apologise for the misspelling of King Canute.
Oh, so many good comedy memories. I mean, yeah. Not the 9 o'clock news, obviously. As well. Obviously, yes. Yeah, way back then.
Yeah,
yeah. So sad passing, yes, of a man from our. You know,
our generation,
exactly. Somebody we remember fondly.
Yes, there. And like I say, yes, the Mel Smith moment of the week. Obviously, I think in tribute has to be the one which spawned the name in the first place.
Yes, of course.
Which was Jesse Taylor, friend of ours from school, who basically got his first job. Working on a graphics package or something in Russell Square, and essentially he saw Mel Smith walking along the street, and he ran out into the street, jumped out in front of him, and went, "Mel!" Not quite understanding that possibly that would have sounded a lot more familiar to someone who he knew called Mel than Mel Smith, and Mel Smith apparently just looked at him and went, "Fuck off," carried on walking without breaking his stride. So, so there you go, ladies and gentlemen, the sad passing of Mel Smith, patron saint of Mel Smith moment of the week.
It is a real pity we're not a Comic Con, because we probably could have done him proud.
We probably could have, but there you go. So, moving on, have you got anything else, Dal, before I move on?
No, it's just about that. That was the thing that I remember, yes, you know,
sorry,
it being quite relevant to the Black Dog. So
yes, indeed. Well, the news that's kind of floating around that's post Comic Con, before we get to the Comic Con stuff,
yeah,
is something you might find rather interesting.
Okay, go ahead.
I'll read you it from Badass Digest verbatim, and then that way we can sort of take it from there. Now, it has come out from Ain't It Cool that this is all bullshit. But then again, it is Ain't It Cool, and so it's kind of a case of who do you believe and what can be verified. None of it can be verified, so take it all with a pinch of salt. But I'll read you exactly what's been said. So, this is from Devin Faraci on Badass Digest, and he writes, "Excellent sources have revealed to me that the new writers of Star Trek 3 have been found. And as expected, Bad Robot is hiring from within the ranks of past collaborators, continuing with the first two films' traditions of having writing teams. The script of Star Trek 3 will be written by duo Ashley Edward Miller and Zach Stentz. Sorry. You may know them as the guys who wrote the first Thor, and they also have writing credits for X-Men First Class. They also wrote for Fringe, and they were also producers on that show."
Hmm.
But anyway, just moving down, keeping in mind this is all isn't a done deal, so it's possible that someone else could end up getting the gig. There's also no guarantee that they are the final writers on a project, but right now Stinson Miller have it's their job to lose, since Paramount wants this movie out by 2016 to mark the 50th anniversary of Star Trek, and work is to begin on it ASAP. But here's the interesting bit. Speaking of losing jobs, why is it that we keep hearing, and I keep hearing, this is directly from Devin Faraci, why is it that I keep hearing tons of rumours that J.J. Abrams is on the verge of dropping out of Star Wars? This has been something that I've heard a while now, and from multiple insiders. I know that he didn't want to shoot the movie in England, and that was overruled, but that happened a while ago. This weekend at Comic-Con, I continue to hear the whispers, and no director for Trek 3 has been found yet. Might Abrams end up coming back after all, leaving Star Wars to someone else? I'm expecting Star Wars news to come out of the German Star Wars celebration at the end of the month. So there is something to be said there. So if we don't hear anything... Hold on, where are we? So if we don't hear anything, any kind of announcement of a title or casting, and Abrams isn't here, start wondering.
Hmm.
So that's an interesting thing, because it basically means there's this possibility that Abrams will be back to direct Star Trek 3. Secondly, Lindelof is off of Star Trek 3.
Good.
Thank fuck.
You should be off of everything.
The fucking planet would be a good start. So what do you think about that? I mean, do you... And obviously that has implications for Star Wars. Now, Lucasfilm have basically put up a sort of pretty blunt sort of denial, saying that, you know, that this is, you know... Yeah, there's no truth in the rumour, Lucasfilm said in a statement issued on Monday. JJ is having a great time working on the script and looking forward to the production next year. But that's it. That's all they've written.
That's all they've said.
So, what do you mean? What do you think?
What do I think? Well, if... Like I say, I still think that the getting the job... on Star Wars. Oh, sorry, I'm not voicing.
No, you're
the
not
mic.
In the mic.
I still think that getting the job on Star Wars might have been a distraction for him when doing the last Star Trek film, which is why I think it was a bit hit and miss with the fans.
Well,
you know,
I know why that was. Yeah, but go on, carry on.
Of course. So, really, I think if it is true and he is going to just drop out the Star Wars job, and let's face it, I know a lot of people say, well, why would you want to drop out of that? I mean, wow, that's a dream job. It's like...
No, it's directing by committee at this point.
Well, it's not even that. It's like, this is Star Wars you're directing. It's like, this isn't just some fucking set of indie films. I mean, look at the amount of flack George Lucas gets for Star Wars, right?
Yeah, you're even walking, today.
Yeah, you're walking into that, right? Mm. You're walking in to be in line... against the, you know, for the firing squad, basically. While the films are not being made, or while they're being made and nobody's watching them, you're everybody's favourite. But as soon as those come out, you're not going to, but you know, you're not going to please everybody.
No.
And you are going to get torn to shreds. So, you know, if he leaves, all props to him, because
you wouldn't take the job.
No, fuck it, I wouldn't. It's too much. You know, I mean, especially if he's still signed on to do Star Trek as well.
Well, there's an on and off rumour that he was signed on to do Star Trek, but yeah, they Star Trek 3 definitely needs to happen by May 15th, 2016, because that is the 50th anniversary of Star Trek.
Right. I would rather, if I had the choice of doing something with anything with Star Wars, I would rather be in it, as in as a character or as a...
You just
want
to dress up.
Yeah, exactly. I like dressing up, don't you know it?
Okay.
Especially on a Saturday evening. But well,
we're going to keep that off the cast.
We certainly are. But yeah, I wouldn't want to direct this. No. I mean, you know, as cool as it might sound, that's an awful lot of pressure. So fine, if he wants to back out of it, you know, I don't think really he can hang his head in shame. It's like. I'm sure that even greater men than him have fucking turned down that part.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, exactly. Cool. Okay. Well, moving on, then let's move to our friend Comic-Con, the giver of news, rumours, and general malaise over the last 72 hours.
Yeah.
Now, there's been lots of rumours, there's been lots of things coming out, there's been lots of announcements, there's been lots of panels, there's been lots of things to be seen. But I think the one which we've got to focus on right front and centre is the one that basically caused me a personal heartburn and despair at the internet fandom in general, which was the announcement that Man of Steel 2 would feature, not necessarily as a cameo, because there's nothing been said, but would feature Batman. Now...
Yeah, there's a lot of speculation.
There's a lot of speculation, but there is no fact. Just so everyone knows, for those of you who don't know, and let's be honest, who the fucking hell's listening to this and doesn't know, but basically, Zack Snyder came into Hall H and said, yeah, Man of Steel 2's going ahead, you know, announcement, everyone went crazy. Then he went, oh yeah, and... But, you know, just to tide you over, there's one more thing, and I'm going to get General What's-His-Face from the first
film. He said,
film.
I've got nothing to add, but I've got...
Yeah, got this guy to read out a little something to give you an idea, you know. And basically, this guy comes out and he reads, essentially, the dialogue line from Batman to Superman from the end of Dark Knight Returns, the Frank Miller book. which is, you know, I want you to remember this moment, Clark. You know,
in your most private moments.
In those moments, I want you to know that it was me who beat you, with my hands around your throat.
Yeah.
And basically, Snyder, the only other thing that was ever said was that Snyder said, we are not adapting this.
Mm.
So, essentially, that's it. That's all you know. The logo turns up, and the logo is basically the same logo as the Superman Batman comics.
Yeah.
Which is a series of them now. And essentially, that's it. That's all we know. We know there's Superman. We know there's Batman. We know Zack Snyder's involved in it. We don't know any casting. We know that there's a touchstone. They're using Dark Knight to sort of formulate the relationship, aka, you know, Batman has got a chip on his shoulder about Superman, the way he does things. And as in those Superman, Batman comics, vice versa.
Sorry, I'm just thinking of the internet meme that I saw this week.
Go on.
Of where you've got to do with the Superman Batman film. Mm. And it's got Superman standing here amongst sort of like all these buildings. And he goes, don't worry, Batman, you go get the Joker. I've taken care of the Penguin. And then what it does is it shows you this smoking ruin of fucking Gotham. And it's got this Photoshop picture of Batman just looking like, what the fuck?
Yeah, I mean, yeah.
But it's the whole thing. It's just like the Penguin that he's going to go at, and he's flattened the city, you know.
Yeah, I mean, the disappointing news is, on top of all of this, is that on the heels of the announcement, it's actually just come up on Badass Digest, I've just noticed, is that it's looking like, rather than being called World's Finest, it is actually going to go, there is a very strong possibility they're going to go with Batman versus Superman as a title.
Really?
That's a bit disappointing. However, we don't know that for sure, so
that
take that
really
with a big pinch of salt. But anyway, so the thing with this, right, the thing I ought to say with this, right, mm-hmm. is the only clues you've got is the line of dialogue from Dark Knight. You've got the picture, the logo, right?
Yeah.
Which is basically the logo from a string of comics, which always does the same thing. If you've never read the Batman Superman comic with that logo on it,
it
basically always tells the story from two perspectives, and it's always like internal monologue. There's hardly ever dialogue, and basically all the thought balloons for Clark are in yellow, and all the thought balloons for Bruce are in blue. And there's always this kind of like whatever's going on, you'll always get both their perspectives, sort of sitting on either side of the frame.
Yeah.
Just so you can always see what they're thinking and how different they are. And there's always this kind of hint of resentment. You know, there's a begrudging respect, but there's a hint of resentment all the way through every single one of these comics. So that's the only clue you've really got. Yet, right? I post this announcement went up at... Zack Snyder said it in 8:30 UK time. No, 9:30 UK time. By the time the internet had disseminated the information, I'd seen it at roughly speaking about 9:40. I posted it up on Facebook around that time. By 9:42, I had about 50 replies going anywhere between that's going to blow goats to that sucks to why are they making a Superman film with a Batman in it? Oh my God, that's so fucking unreal. That's not right. By the time I got to like one of these websites like Badass Digest, which I do actually rate as one of the better film sites.
It's got some good stuff on there.
You know, everyone had basically shit on this film and written it off. Every single person I knew. Now, you know, contributor and co-host at certain times, Danny Graydon, has been quite vociferous about the fact that he doesn't want to see another sequel to Man of Steel with any characters in it. But he's quite happy to have things like Captain America, where the next sequel is the Avengers. But, you know, and there seems to be this weird double standard, weird thing where it's like, whatever Marvel do, if DC do it, it's wrong. But we haven't seen anything. And it really has exasperated me in the last 72 hours. All I've done is look at the whole world and just go, what?
I've got my own view on the whole DC thing anyway.
yeah, I'll let you come in a second. But the one thing I wanted to just say, just to wrap it all up, is if you don't want to see the film, and you don't want to see it because you don't like the writer, you don't like the director, you don't like the last film, that's perfectly fine. Do you know, that's fine? Because I've made a vow that anything with Damon Lindelof's name in the fucking writing credits or producer credits, I am not going within 10,000 yards of. Similarly, Paul W.S. Anderson. If I go near either of these two, it's either going to be because someone else has got that bloody film and is showing it to me, or I've lost my mind, frankly. That's it. There's no other reason why I'm going to do that, right?
Yeah, you're not.
So that I understand. If there's an actual reason because you don't like certain things. So if you don't like a Zack Snyder film, and you really don't like Zack Snyder, and Sucker Punch nearly put me off him forever, I understand that. I respect that. But what seems to be coming about now is it's just because someone says Superman, Batman, everyone's just standing there like retarded monkeys going, at the internet. For no real discernible reason other than just because it's the easiest answer. And it just really fucking annoyed me, that, because it was like, the film's 24 months off. I mean, you haven't even confirmed for sure that Henry Cavill's coming back as Superman. You've got no information whatsoever. And yet everyone said, oh, it's rubbish. Really? Does no one remember all of this garbage that we went through with fucking X-Men First Class? No one remember that? Oh no, it's not set in the same X-Men universe. Oh no, we're not using the same continuity as the Bryan Singer films. It's not the same as in the comics, because in the comics we went back in time to 1960s, and I think you'll find Beast didn't have hairy feet. And it's just like, right, fine, go on, shit on it all you like. Now tell me that you didn't like the film. And it's just like, because... And it's the same thing. It's the same thing, but it's massively compressed behind the lens of 10 million fucking geeks who just seem to think that they are the font of all knowledge and their opinion is all. And everyone's just gone that way. I understand if you don't like the person, you don't like the film, you don't like the films that they make, that's fine. But don't shit on a film where you have absolutely no information to base it on that you would make a critical evaluation. If you don't mind Zack Snyder's films, fine. Why are you shitting on this film? If you don't mind Superman films, fine. Why are you shitting on this film? If you don't mind Batman films, why are you shitting on this film? If you don't... You know, I don't get it. I don't get what happened in less than 20 minutes. I just don't understand it, and it really fucked me off, because I just think... I suddenly thought I was surrounded by... complete fucking knee-jerk idiots, and especially in certain circumstances where you'd actually challenge their opinion and say things like, okay, so you don't want to see a sequel with another character in it. What, you mean like Iron Man 2 or The Avengers, which was essentially a sequel to the Hulk, to the Thor, to Captain America? You don't want to see that sort of thing. And the fact is, you know, in Comic-Con, they even announced that they were going to make a Justice League film. So, okay.
They've made an official announcement that they are going ahead with it, yeah?
2016.
Okay.
Then The Flash. They're aiming to get the both of them out. And it's like, so, they're trying to do The Flash, and they're trying to do Justice League, and you've also got to get Superman and Batman together as, like, you know, founding members of the Justice League. We'll put them in the next film. But no, suddenly it's gone from, oh, Man of Steel is this film which is rubbish and we don't fucking like it, to, oh no, it needs another sequel, it needs time to breathe. It's like, really? 5 minutes ago, everyone fucking hated it and couldn't shit on it from a great enough height. And now all of a sudden it's like, oh no, no, we love this universe and it needs time to be elaborated upon. It's like, stick to your fucking story. Either you liked it or you fucking didn't. Don't keep changing your fucking opinion just because everyone else changes their opinion. Change your opinion because you've got an opinion. And that's what really fucking wound me up, because it just felt like everyone just trying to fall in, and everyone, it was like, it's like someone farted in a lift.
Yeah.
And no one knows who, and the lift's crowded. And everyone looks at each other and they all start smiling at each other because they know that the person who doesn't look at them will be the odd one out. And everyone just starts smiling and looking at each other because they all want to be a part of the group. And it's exactly the same thing. It just was so exasperating. But anyway, that's it. So, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, I was as giddy as a schoolboy when that fucking announcement happened. It happened live streaming on my screen, and it was like, bloody hell, thank you very much indeed. I'll have some of that.
Yeah.
Until I see otherwise, if a trailer comes out and it looks like shit, fine, then I'll make a decision then. But I can't make a decision based on fucking nothing.
Mm.
I just don't see how people are doing that. And then, anyway, so it really pissed me off.
I can understand why it would piss you off.
Yeah. So anyway, over to you, sir, because you came out with an opinion.
I came out with an opinion, and it's not based on when this hit, I saw what you'd written,
yeah,
and I saw other reactions to it, and I thought I'm going to be the odd one out of everybody because I've got no passion for this. It's not the fact that I'm thinking it's going to be shit or anything like this. It's just, I was like, so what?
Right.
That was my entire attitude. Now, I will admit that one part of my Facebook update, I now admit, was a bit strong.
Mm.
Okay, and I shouldn't have said it because...
Well, you expected it to die on its arse.
Yeah, exactly. Well, no, it's just like, yeah, it was like, I was like, you know what? I really couldn't give a shit about this news. It's not that I thought it was going to be, like, terrible or anything. It's just, with the Batman and Superman thing, it seems every 6 months somebody wheels that out as this is going to, it's going ahead, and it doesn't happen. I've heard this so many times. When it finally comes out it's like the Cry Wolf thing.
Yeah.
You know, I've heard it so many times now, even an official statement like, we're going to do it. It's like, yeah, sure. You told us you were going to do a Justice League movie with George Miller. Where the fuck did that disappear to?
Yeah.
Fine. Oh, if you bring it out, you bring it out. Whatever. Mm. You know, actions speak louder than words.
Yeah.
And I had a bit more thought about it. I mean, I'm a bit better about it now. Mm. I think that it was just Saturday when I was out. I wasn't in a very good mood anyway, and a lot of people I was out will tell you it took me a while to start coming around to the pub atmosphere because I really wasn't feeling too good.
No.
But so I think I will admit my reaction on there was a bit of a strong one. The apathy, though...
apathy is a different kettle of fish.
Yeah.
I mean, apathy is just no excitement to the thing, and that's understandable. If you don't feel excitement, fine.
This is it, because I just read the words. I didn't do what you did. I didn't see the announcement.
Mm.
Had I seen that, I might have been a little bit more thing. But as it was at the time, I think general mood and whatever. I still don't feel uber-like, you know, wake up, fuck yes, this is going to be a Superman Batman movie. I think, all right, there's going to be one. But, and this is the thing as well, I reserve the right to have my mind changed, to be convinced otherwise of this, okay?
Yeah.
It's like, again, using that X-Men First Class argument.
That was the best example I could come up with.
Exactly. No, but I'm using that as well.
Yeah.
I've had this before. We both have. Mm. It's like, you know, there is that argument of, you know, with the whole thing about prejudging something even before it's hit the dirt. It's like, so how's that RoboCop 3 movie making you feel at the moment? We haven't seen anything of that, and yet people were a downer on that. Ghostbusters 3, another as well. I know it's like people think, fucking old Dan. But it's like, we all jumped on that and we slagged it off straight away because it's Ghostbusters 3 and it's Dan Aykroyd. But how do we know it's not going to be any good?
I mean, I do take that point. I mean, the one thing, I mean...
But I'm just, one in there with that. I'm sitting there slagging it off with you.
I get that. I mean, I think the difference here, I mean... Let's put it this way, yeah? Just to put it in context, using RoboCop and Ghostbusters.
Not RoboCop 3, sorry. RoboCop 3 should burn in hell.
RoboCop 3 should be buried under a quicklime fucking mill.
Yeah.
But anyway.
Shallow grave.
But the thing with the remake of RoboCop, right, is firstly, it doesn't need to happen. It doesn't need to be one. Beyond that, everything we've seen of it... See, this is what I'm saying. We have seen things of it. We have... reports, we have set reports, we have trailer nods, we have new news, which I was going to put on the news, but we'll just use this as an example, and it's a part of the news, which is, it's been announced it's going to be a PG-13.
Having experience is something that should be higher rating.
World War Z.
Yeah.
But becomes a...
Damon Lindelof. Yeah.
Is it, was he...
He wrote the last third.
Oh, fucking hellfire. I so want to get him in a headlock. Right, okay. Anyway,
anyway, carry on.
Yeah, so another thing as well with the apathy, I think I figured out where the apathy is because it started confusing me. Why aren't I feeling more excited about this?
Mm.
And I've said about the whole history thing about Batman and Superman gets wheeled out every 6 months, you know. But well,
putting
it's
posters
like,
in fucking I Am Legend.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But there's something else then.
Go on.
It's and surprisingly... And really quite saddeningly to me, it's not Superman that's the problem. It's Batman. Batman.
Yeah.
Right? The door, we've just heard the door slam on Batman's last three films.
Yeah.
Right? I've still not got over those, as in I need to get those out of my system because they kind of...
They're their own thing.
Yeah, but they did a bit more... They did some damage to me, those films, where Batman's really? Concerned. Yeah. They... Okay. I don't know. I think it was even the last one. It was just...
Last one was balls.
I know. There wasn't... There, it was just... It was just too... It was just too going the other way from what the other stuff was. Mm. It was just too...
It lost the fantasy element.
Yeah, it was too miserable. It was. I know Batman's a dark character, but I mean, even in things like the TV show, because he's still a dark character. The original cartoon that came out, the one that everybody really liked,
the
one that Kevin Conroy voiced, that showed you could still do the dark stuff in it. But I don't know.
There's a balance.
I think it's the whole Christian Bale thing as well. I don't want to see him ever as Batman again.
No.
Ever. I really am done with that version of Batman.
No, that's fine. And that's, you know what? That's fine.
It's that. I think it's that as well. But, and this is where the hope starts coming back. Somebody wrote something on Facebook.
Yeah.
It was one, I think it was in yours. I actually put a like on it. And he suggested something that, you know, maybe I should have thought of as a storyline. Superman... Lex Luthor. Lex Luthor's starting to rise, corrupt businessman. This is where Batman comes in, because Batman is investigating Lex Luthor. And it's like, well, if they do something like that, then, all right, maybe.
What is, yeah.
And who knows, I mean, I'm hoping that where Batman's concerned, Zack Snyder kind of takes a little bit more control of it than Nolan. Because if Nolan takes control of it, we'll just get a repeat of what we've seen. And I don't want that.
No. Well, what we know is that, obviously, if Snyder's involved, the action sequences will be more up front compared to Nolan, you know, who's more up and happy to have the characters sit there and just talk.
Yeah.
But, I mean...
I want to see a Batman who's the I told you so. Batman,
yeah,
you know, it's like it's got always got that the little plan in place.
What was that one that Andy Palacides put on the Facebook group where it's
like, oh man, I've injected my bones with liquid kryptonite.
As long as you don't throw me into a nuclear reaction that would make me emanate kryptonite rays, so long, sucker. Sign Bruce, and there he is burning in the sun or something.
And then you see Superman melting, going, "Good play, Bruce.
Yeah, well played.
Good play.
Well played." But
You know, I reserve the right to be convinced otherwise. I think I'm down at the bottom there, right?
But that's a perfectly reasonable position to be. If you've been knocked about by the last iteration of Superman, the last iteration of Batman, then you're not exactly going to be enthused to see the next one. However, you're in a position where it's like, show me what to think. Yeah, you know, show me what's out there, and I'll think about.
If something comes along that convinces me otherwise, you know, it's like it starts picking up my interest.
Exactly.
Then it's like, I want to see that Superman universe expanded, right? I want to see where they go next with this. I want to see how he deals with what he did in the last film. There's interesting things, you know, little tick boxes I've got for this next Superman film to come out.
What do you mean? No, I mean, just this is the thing. 10 minutes worth of thought. And I know this is me going the other way now. This is me being fanboyish. But the fact of the matter is, they started off, they quoted that Dark Knight line.
Yeah.
Right? Most, well, for the as Jim put on the Facebook group, for the last fucking 75 years of Batman and Superman history, the two characters run across each other, will have a fight, will basically find some kind of common ground, will realise they're fighting, they shouldn't be fighting each other, they should be working together, and then, hey presto, they work together to beat the real bad guy.
Yeah.
You know, it's happened in World's Finest, it's innumerable times, it's happened in Hush, it happened in, you know, fucking Dark Knight, it's happened in everything.
Yep.
Now, the fact of the matter is, we've seen in Man of Steel, we saw a Wayne Industries satellite. Okay.
And we saw LexCorp. And we saw LexCorp. When I saw those bits in there, I was generally like, ooh, nice.
Yeah. So, what is to say, you know, Superman's relatively new. And as we've all said, you know, he was a bit of a cynical bastard compared to what everyone was expecting Superman to be. But then you put him against Batman, and it defines him. Because suddenly, he is the Boy Scout compared to a bloke who dresses up as a bat and will quite cheerfully hang someone off of a fucking building.
I'm hoping that now that we've dealt with his family issues in the first one, that we now start seeing him, that's kind of like a weight off of his spirit, and we do start seeing the hopeful...
You see the hope coming through at the end.
Yeah.
And that's my point. I just think that in some ways, as mad as it is, and we are rolling on, we haven't done anything.
But it's an interesting subject.
But the fact is, you know, at the end of the day, putting Batman in a Superman universe and vice versa, it's not like they haven't met before. If you do it in the films, you are defining Clark, because he will go only so far, and he'll go only so far, and Batman will go further. And similarly, Batman will go only so far and then will want to go further, and Clark stops him. The two characters are polar opposites of the same coin. So at the end of the day, to me, to define Superman, you would put him up against someone like Batman initially, and you would have them both kind of work a begrudging respect and say, oh, fucking hell, okay, right, I don't like the way you do things and you don't like the way I do things, but you've got what I need and I've got what you need and we've got to get on and do this. And, you know, having this angle of Superman being like, he's an alien, he's doing untold damage, and he's doing that thing that Lex hates, which is, you know, he's basically a god amongst men.
Yeah.
You know, you put Batman in that, and he's going to have a complex about the fucking thing, isn't he? He's going to be like, well, hold on. What's going on over here? You know, how do I know you're the good guy? You know, all this sort of Superman turning around going, you're just going to have to trust me. It's like, no. You know, you could see that sort of thing happening. So, I just think there's a lot of potential here. And all these people going, oh, well, Superman's got to have his own sequel. Okay, so what would we have in the sequel? Darkseid? Brainiac? I mean, because if you have Lex Luthor again, those very same people are going, oh, but it's just like the Donner films. And it's just like, you can't win. And the problem you can't win from is you can't win from fanboys who really can't let go. And Superman seems to get those fanboys. I mean, all respect to anyone here who's a Superman fanboy, but the fact of the matter is, it just seems like the character has to be exactly like the comics or there is no point. And it's like, X-Men proved it. Fucking every other superhero comic adaptation has proved it. You've got to have a bit of leeway.
Yeah. I don't think it's wrong to try to add a different angle to a character, as long as it doesn't go off too far. As long as you've still got the basics there, I think it's fine. And given, you know, I think they've approached it from a psychological point of view, where Superman's concerned, this not knowing, you know, knowing that he's like, or discovering that he's not, you know, he doesn't actually belong to Martha and Jonathan Kent, is like, he's never met his parents, he doesn't know where he comes from, they don't know where he's come from. And it's that whole thing. I mean, the whole point of him walking off and doing the soul-searching thing, I think it's very much interconnected with that. And, you know, it is that, you know, where do I belong? I'm lost. And then there's that whole complex with Jonathan Kent and, you know, what happens to Jonathan sealing that paranoia that Clark has got for fear of breaking it, for, you know, not wanting to break it for fear of dishonouring the memory of Jonathan Kent. you know, for not revealing himself. I know, sorry if people have not seen Superman. I'm sure everybody has now, but
by this point, I don't think anyone who isn't listening, if they're not seen it by now, well,
yeah,
yeah.
I think they were all logical steps in Clark's progression in that film, being off, going off, and you know, just wandering and trying to find his place. Mm. But like I say, I think I'm hoping that the next film will have him knowing where his place is now and just exploring that and being a lot happier because he knows.
Exactly. And then, you know, like I say, we'll wait and see.
Yeah.
But, you know, and like I say, apathy, that's fine. Not wanting to see the film because, you know, you disagree with a writer or director or whatever, that's fine as well. But shit on a film 20 minutes after it's been announced, I mean, that is utter lunacy. And dress it up with, you know, haw-hawing and fucking, oh yes, how now, Brown Cow, there should be more fucking sequels for Superman before he gets a partnership. You know, 10 minutes after saying, oh well, have you seen how DC are getting run over by Marvel because, like, you know, they don't make these films quick enough. And then 5 minutes later, they make the films quick enough and it's only like, oh, they're making these films too quick.
I think...
Well, what the fuck do you want?
Where the whole DC trying to do things... The thing that kind of... It's kind of... I don't know. It kind of upsets me about all that is that DC should have probably been the first company to do something like this, right?
No, they're too old school.
Well, whatever. It's this, the whole cynical thing about this is that, you know, it took Marvel Studios to take a leap of faith to do what they did, and all of a sudden Marvel was scrambling, DC are scrambling to copy it, and I think that kind of wrinkles me, that it's now a scramble, and it's like,
It's not thought out.
Look, I don't care if you bring this all out, if you start the ball rolling in 2020, right? Don't just do it.
You'll be fucking 50 by then.
Well, what this... I'm thinking about the whole Batman-Superman thing, and, all right, you're approaching it a slightly different way, right? Instead of having each hero with their own film, you're blurring the lines even more by having Batman turn up in Superman, if that's what they're going to do. Right, so fine, you have the next Batman film is in back in Gotham doing his own thing. Just please don't do an origin story now. We've been saturated with that. We know Batman Begins kind of sealed that. I like Batman Begins. The other two movies that followed it, again, a bit soul draining. But Batman Begins, I'd like to keep that as the memory of the Batman origin.
That's the origin.
Yeah, do the fucking Watchmen thing in the next Batman film of his parents getting killed in the credits and all that kind of shit. Zack Snyder has shown us the way where that's building up the origin's concerned. Do it in the credit sequence. Fucking do it like that. Get it out of the way. Let's get on with it. You know? So, yeah, I think that's what wrinkles me about the DC thing is that it seems too...
Yeah, the cynical thing.
It's the money that's driven it, and it's not the passion.
No, but then that's always been the case with DC and Warners.
Yeah.
There's very rarely... And the worst bit is that when they do get passionate, they get things like Pacific Rim, and then suddenly they're proven wrong.
Yeah, exactly.
Which just annoys me as well.
Anyway, look, yes, we should move on to other stuff about Comic-Con.
Well, yeah, I was going to say, we're already into an hour already.
It's okay, Comic-Con. Fine. Comic-Con's a big thing.
Next thing was Joss Whedon turned up and announced the title for Avengers 2.
Yeah, which...
Which is The Age of Ultron.
That was a big rug puller for me.
Yes.
Because I'm expecting to hear Avengers 2... was it Thanos' cock or something like this, you know, and there we go.
Yeah.
But it's like Avengers 2, Age of Ultron.
No.
What? No?
Because for those of you who don't know, Ultron is basically a robot.
Oh, God. Sorry, I've just remembered something else that's a bit of a rumour people are speculating on as well where this is concerned. Well, but carry on. Tell them about Ultron.
In the comics, Ultron was a robot built by a guy called Hank Pym, who would later become Ant-Man and Giant-Man, depending on which version of the bloody Avengers you're reading. Ultron has adamantium robot, so he's virtually indestructible.
Yeah, let's just say that Ultron was actually created for a purpose. He was a prison guard,
yes.
And there were many of him. Basically, yes. It was a whole range of robots.
For a superhero prison.
For a supervillain prison, that's it. That's right. So the big house, which was a tiny, tiny, tiny thing, which villains were shrunk down into.
Into, yeah.
That's right,
now,
yeah.
Now, the thing right there is, you know, obviously, Ultron then learned and evolved and basically then got this kind of daddy issues thing with Hank Pym and has been, you know, without mercy trying to kill him and in turn the Avengers.
Yeah.
Hank also then went on to build another Avenger called the Vision, which is the one that we were expecting Agent Coulson to become.
That's where the rumor is concerned.
Oh God! Because right, Agent Coulson's in the Shield TV show.
Yeah, you're not going to like what I've got to tell you.
Well, anyway, the thing is, we know that Hank Pym is going to turn up in the Ant-Man film, but that's going to be Phase 3 for Avengers, and we've already seen some test footage of that, so that looks quite cool. The Edgar Wright stuff.
Yeah, if they do that little jumping around fighting sequence, that's like that's really intelligent use of his powers. The whole
exactly. The only thing is, obviously, Hank Pym won't be in Avengers 2.
Hank Pym may be, but not Ant-Man.
No, well, the thing is that the announcement trailer for Avengers 2 was actually Iron Man's helmet appearing and getting bashed into shape to make the Ultron face mask. Now, the implication that a lot of people are reading into it, and again, I stress we know nothing about this film yet, but the implication of just that visual is that actually it's a Tony Stark Iron Man model.
Okay.
Rather than a Hank Pym created thing.
Can I just interject also? Sure. Just one other aspect, which something that makes Ultron just a little bit above just a robot with daddy issues is the fact that he is Marvel's equivalent of the Borg, which means that every time you defeat him, he learns. And that's
it. And the next version comes out better.
Exactly.
So you get Ultron 1 and then Ultron 7 and
stuff like that.
That was the last book I ever read where he's up to like version 7 and it like took the whole of the Avengers to take one robot down.
Exactly. So, he learns basically by what you do, and then once that's happened, there's no way of defeating him the same way.
No.
You have to think of something else.
Yes. So, what do you think of that?
I don't know. I really don't know. It was a real rug puller.
Yeah.
I know people went crazy when it was announced, but it's like, I'm expecting Thanos.
Yeah, because the other thing is,
so where does Thanos come into this?
I don't know, because the thing is also the other real weird bit is that Marvel have only just finished an actual comic book called Age of Ultron, where it's like an alternate reality where basically Ultron has killed pretty much every one of the superheroes. He's evolved to a point where he has destroyed pretty much all of them, and it wasn't great, I'll be honest with you.
Right.
But, yeah, it's just such a weird left turn. I was kind of a bit, a bit raggy.
Exactly. It's like, fine, we know Ultron. Ultron is kind of like, you know, if you read comics, you will have heard of Ultron anyway, but it's just...
You hope.
I really wanted Thanos, but there you go. I've not been upset so far by something that, you know, like Marvel Studios have produced in the whole Avengers thing. I will have a bit of faith and think, all right, fine, get on with it. Blow me away.
So, yeah, I mean...
Oh, and this is the rumour now. This is
go
we
on, yeah,
the
run
rumor.
The rumour past me, yeah.
The Vision, this is the whole rumour about the Vision, is it won't be played, of course, by Clark, thing he plays, Agent Coulson.
Right.
But... And if you've been seen, if you've been seeing the news. And
no,
the
not no, 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 yeah. no, no.
I'll tell you
no,
this: no, the man's got a voice no, like this, no, and he normally plays a character who can
Vin
only
Diesel.
See in the dark.
Fuck Vin Diesel as the Vision, seriously.
But there's this thing about he's been in talks with Marvel about being in the Avengers 2. Now, there was talk that he was going to be Goliath.
A fucking doorstop.
No, Goliath, which is like Giant Man.
Mm.
But people are now saying that because it's the Age of Ultron, he may very well be the Vision.
Or he may very well be the voice of Ultron.
He could be. But to tell you the truth, if he's the voice, if he's Vision, then he's got the voice for it. And as somebody pointed out, I mean, even Vin Diesel can't fuck up playing an emotionless cold robot, you know, so...
Yeah, who gets to fuck the Scarlet Witch?
Exactly. Well, there's a... Well, that's a whole strange tangent of fucking what happens there with
well,
him and the Scarlet Witch.
It.
Yes, indeed. And in the comics, they do indeed get married. And then because he's a robot, she makes herself pregnant by creating children out of thin air.
Because she can
and
distort reality.
This is where the whole House of M thing, and it just goes completely
yeah.
mental.
Yeah, that's when Marvel skates dangerously close to the yeah. to the fucking Captain Crazy Crunch fucking
it, it goes a
it
bit
just
like
goes
that.
A bit bonkers.
Yes. Yeah. If you've ever read I think it's called Avengers Forever. It came out in the Marvel graphic novel collection, a two-parter. And quite frankly, it's just...
Fucking cuckoo.
It is. It's written by a five-year-old. Yeah. I'm sure of it, because yeah. I didn't enjoy
and
it.
And then Iron Man did this, and then the Vision did that, and then everything happened.
And we're going to get all these in place to tie up all these loose ends throughout the entire history of Marvel Comics.
And then they all went home for their tea.
Yeah. Oh, man.
Okay, let's briefly shoot through what's left.
Guardians of the Galaxy.
Yeah, okay, fine. Yeah, more Marvel news. I mean, there was a teaser for X-Men First Class 2 or Days of Future Past with loads and loads of sort of panels with the characters and all the actors. Every single person was there. Was it Peter Dinklage has been confirmed as Bolivar Trask, the inventor of the Sentinels?
Yep. Have you seen the Sentinel?
The Sentinel. One of the Sentinel heads was on display at the Comic-Con.
Yeah.
Looks a bit too Transformers for my liking.
I just like, why not just use the sort of like something very similar to the ones that they've got?
However,
the glass front and stuff?
Yeah, however, it is worth mentioning that there's lots of posters that were hanging around the outside of that, which were more standard looking Sentinels.
So that
could just be a version one.
Okay.
But anyway, we'll worry about that when we get to see more of it.
They did actually give away, or they did actually say a part of the synopsis as well, what's going to happen in it, whereas it diverges from the original story, is that it's it's not Kitty Pryde that goes back into the past. She sends someone into the past. Do you know who that's going to be?
Yes.
Shall we say?
Yes.
Schnickety schnick, Wolverine.
Yes.
So, yeah, he goes back to try and get help from...
Yeah, he basically possesses his own body from the past, doesn't he? That's what it is. That's how they do it.
Something like that, yeah.
They just send his mind back. Yeah, I don't know. Days of Future Past, the original, was never my favourite. And
I've never actually read it, to tell you the truth. That's probably one that I should get hold of.
It's a typical Star Trek kind of thing. It kind of like, they go back in time, and then they solve the problem... Do they sort of? Yeah, that's how it's always left, and it's always like,
because you know they did it. Mm. They redid all that years and years and years later, which I must admit was actually pretty good. The Age of Apocalypse,
which is
where you had like the one-handed Wolverine and the Incredible Hulk, because it was a switch on everything. That was all the good guys. Yeah. Mostly the good guys were actually the bad guys in it, and it was vice versa with the.
Yeah.
And it's like, you know, David Banner and actually the Incredible Hulk would become a hitman.
Mm.
Stuff like this, and he was taking apart mutants in the front and center. And
anyway,
lots of stuff, lots of stuff.
Right, moving on, there was a still and a still released, for Rise of the Planet of the Apes?
Yes,
Dawn of the Planet of the Apes. Sorry,
one that I am looking forward to seeing
more than I am. But Apparently, Andy Serkis let slip that the apes are still learning to communicate, so they're not fully talking yet. But
well,
Caesar
good.
Has
that's
some
good.
Skills. Not much in the way of details, but Caesar, the ape, looks, or chimp, whichever way you want to put it, looks a lot older now. So it's set a lot more further in the future.
He's actually holding a spear as well, by the looks of it.
He is indeed. Yeah, I'm not going to make much of the comment on that because I didn't really pay attention to that one.
No.
Where else are we? What else we got? Then there's then there's Godzilla. There's been lots and lots and lots and lots of stuff about Godzilla. There's been the Godzilla Experience, which is a ride, which has shown. Did you not see that?
Please tell me it's just a roller coaster and it's not a touchy feely fucking hell. We're going into another Godzilla.
No. Oh, right. Okay. What? Allow me to elaborate then, sir.
Okay.
Basically, you get taken. It's an Alien War style thing.
Oh fuck.
Yeah. So basically, you go into a building, and the building, they take you up in a lift. And as they take you up in a lift, the lift's going up and up and up and up and up. All of a sudden, all the lights go out in the lift. Everything shakes and bumps and you can hear stuff going on. Dust falls from the ceiling. The lift makes it to the next floor. Everyone gets ushered out. And basically, while they're trying to get everyone out, Godzilla actually walks across the window of, you know, off in the distance. Way off, you see him walk across the window. And then all of a sudden, they sort of say, oh, you know, just get everyone out. And then fucking next thing, you know, the head comes up right in front of the glass, staring at everyone. So that was the first bit. That's the Godzilla Experience. Which apparently they're going to be doing on a number of rides, but that was like the first time anyone's seen it.
Fucking hell.
So that was, apparently a bit shitty. But not shitty as in shit. But then what happened was, then a piece of actual footage got shown of Godzilla. And the description basically runs that you got a big monster, totally different monster, attacking an airport.
Yeah.
And everyone's screaming and shouting, and there's this thing kind of smashing the fuck out of the airport. Then all of a sudden, you see a foot come down, and the foot is Godzilla. And this thing is so big that the monster that's attacking the airport looks about 2 foot tall. And you apparently, the shot is that you're sort of seeing it from the ground. So you see the monster, and then you just see the shadow of Godzilla come right up behind it. and it doesn't last very long.
No, I bet it does. He probably just goes... Poink.
Yeah, just like...
Yeah.
So apparently that's looking very good, very exciting. The only thing I've got a problem with at the moment is the fact that the poster came out and Godzilla's tail is so big that it literally breaks the cloud line.
Yeah.
And it's like... Hold on, so this thing is like several miles tall?
Could be. Are they pushing this as Godzilla Protector of the Earth, or
I don't know,
is that kind of Godzilla?
I think it may be that kind of Godzilla, because they did say that, you know, it attacks the monsters that are attacking the airport,
yeah,
rather than attacking the people. So yeah, hopefully it's going that way. It's going for a bit more sort of classic post 1956 Godzilla, but the design apparently is very much like the old one.
Any sign of Godzuki?
No. Thank fuck.
And Godzuki.
Do, 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 do. Right, there you go. So, that's that. There are a few more other bits. Comic-Con stuff. There was a Warcraft trailer.
World of Warcraft. I heard about that, yes.
Nothing too fancy. Apparently, you just got to see... Like
a bloke and an orc
having a bit of a dust up. And then of course we've got Guardians of the Galaxy.
Yes.
Now Guardians of the Galaxy had some trailer stuff, had a panel, and there's been some concept art as well. And frankly, from the sound description and some of the shots, it looks like it's going to be fucking bonkers. But it also looks like it's going to be really funny.
I liked the panel that they did with the cast, and I must admit, the guy who's playing Star-Lord is absolutely hilarious. He's brilliant. Zoe Saldana, she was either very, very tired or very, very drunk.
Right, okay.
One of the two. I'm not sure which.
Which we obviously won't be putting any kind of spin on in case we ever get sued.
But if you see her, you've watched watch the actual panel and just see the way she starts acting.
Yeah.
It's like...
she's off her tits.
Yeah.
Yeah. Either on sleep deprivation or something else.
I think it's probably sleep deprivation. But,
of course, that's what we would say.
Yes, we would.
Yeah, apparently, yeah, it's got a real nice straight line of humour, including Star-Lord being lined up against the sort of usual suspect style wall, and then all the police going, so what's his name? Star-Lord. Who calls him Star-Lord? Mainly himself. And it's, and Rocket Raccoon. Even shots of Rocket Raccoon.
Yeah, they've not picked a voice yet.
No.
And also for Gru as well.
Groot.
Groot, who's the... Groot the Root.
Groot, who's a tree.
Yes, indeed. Although they do have... Drax, who's played by Dave Bautista. He's a WWF wrestler. And they've got...
Rooker.
Michael Rooker, who's playing... I can't remember the character's name now.
Hold on. Yeah, the most amazing thing about all of this, though, is the fact that it's only been filming for like 12 days.
Yes, it has.
And it's like, so they've literally done 2 weeks of filming. They've already got a finished effects shot and, you know, some shots in the can.
Yeah.
It's like, fucking hell, that's a bit serious.
Well, somebody did ask in the, one of the reporters did ask a question of like, you know, so what's been your favourite scenes together? And Zoe Saldana's like, well, we've only filmed about 15% of the movie, so, you know, still a lot more to go. Thank you very much indeedy.
Yeah, here's another dialogue line, which again kind of underlines the Star-Lord thing. One of the Nova Corp corners Star-Lord.
Yeah.
And says, and I quote, should I know who you are? Said one of the Star Cops. Star-Lord, says Star-Lord. You know, legendary outlaw, you know, scourge of the seas. I'll forget it. So he basically has a massive opinion of himself.
Yep.
Which essentially is not borne out by anyone knowing who the fuck he is. So that sounds quite cool. Oh, and apparently he gets really upset when people try and mess with his Walkman. And starts playing Hooked on the... Yeah, and he's trying to look all hard, and then one guy gets his Walkman, turns it on, and it's playing Hooked on a Feeling. Yeah. So there's...
David Hasselhoff classic.
Yeah, so apparently that's playing throughout the rest of the trailer while there's lots of shots of people fighting and stuff. So it could be just the craziest fucking thing ever.
Could be.
But certainly that's the one thing that I took away as being the success of the thing. Oh, and...
The Thor 2 panel. I'm not going to say anything more about it.
Yes.
Just put in Thor 2 Comic-Con 2013. Sit back and watch it. And watch the longest version you can find as well.
Yes.
You'll love it. It's they went out. Yes. They went out on a... when I did themselves this one.
Yeah, exactly. It's very good. Right, okay, well, we could just carry on talking Comic-Con and just completely skip the rest of this fucking podcast.
Yeah.
But we won't. Oh, no. We won't. We won't talk about superheroes on Comic-Con, because you know why?
Why?
Because I've got one right here for you.
It's time for Shitty Heroes, baby. The guys who never save the day. It's time for Shitty Heroes, baby. Who are these guys anyway?
Right, okay. So, from one bunch of shitty superheroes to the other. Okay, right, fine. Darren, firstly, tell me, have you seen this iPad before?
No, I've not seen this iPad
Brilliant.
Before.
Okay, well, let's just get on with this one then. This character's name, has that cat just done a shit? Can you smell that?
I can smell cat food, I think.
That's
I think
not
it's cat food.
That's not cat food, I've not fed that cat.
Then it's I would say it's done a big shit.
There will now be a short intermission.
Albatross! Albatross!
God. Fucking hell.
That was a bit rough.
The cat doesn't like the fucking section. It should just say. It doesn't need to take a dump in the fucking place. Right, back to shitty superheroes.
Okay.
In more ways than one.
I'm taking a beer.
Taking a beer. Okay. This character and his brother.
Christian Bale. I'll take it
now. Yeah, take
beer.
A beer. Okay. This guy turned up in Defenders number 25, July 1975, which was written by Steve Gerber and drawn by Sal Buscema. Now, this guy was called Melf. And.
Melf?
Melf. M-E-L-F.
You sure it's not?
No.
M-I.
His brother, who would later appear in the series, basically it was called Ralph. And, well, basically, I'll just tell you, essentially cut it right down. He is an elf with a gun.
Melf the elf.
With a gun.
With a gun. No, it's not quite got the same ring to it as Melf the elf, full stop.
No, it's just called Elf with a Gun. And
right.
Basically, his entire MO was as a random force of nature. He would just appear, kill someone, and never be seen again throughout the whole run of the Defenders. There was no rhyme, no reason, no anything. He just was a little tiny leprechaun, shamrocky type dude.
With a shotgun.
With a pistol.
Oh, right.
Yeah, he killed Tom and Linda Pratchett in episode 25 of The Defenders. And over the series of a bunch of issues, he killed Charles Lester and his spouse in Las Vegas.
They're not doing much defending, are they?
No. Stu and his girlfriend at the Grand Canyon and the woman hiding from the Hulk in a bathroom. He met his end, however, in upstate New York when he was preparing to kill a newspaper delivery boy for no reason when he was run over by a Mack truck. Unfortunately, because he was about to kill the newspaper boy didn't actually notice. And so his death went past without event. He just turned up, wanted to kill a newspaper boy, got run over by a Mack truck. And that's about it. Another elf, called Ralph, revealed himself to the Defenders, and said that, you know, basically if he ever had cause, he would come back and wage more terror upon the Earth, leading to the belief that he may have been the same elf who got run over by a Mack truck. However, he revealed that his name was Ralph instead of Melf.
Makes all the difference.
Apparently it does. That's it, really. I mean, yeah, he was basically the embodiment of a force of nature. Just would randomly turn up in one frame of Defenders, kill someone, and then that'd be that.
Right.
So, this week's shitty superhero is Elf with a Gun.
Kind of does what it says on its tin, really, doesn't it? Let's have a look at that. Oh, my good Lord. It's just a normal six-shooter. It's not even like a special elf gun with lasers on it or something.
Nope, it's just a normal pistol. Oh, I still smell like cat shit, man. Oh. Yeah.
Oh, Jesus.
Hit by a Mack truck and died.
Whatever, man.
There you go. So, Elf with a Gun. This week's shitty superhero. You're looking nonplussed. Just... yeah, moving on. There you go.
Yeah, he's the big villain in Avengers 3. That's a real rug puller, that one.
Yeah, Avengers 3, Elf with a Gun.
What?
What the fuck? Anyway, speaking of what the fuck, let's move on now to Jim Moon's Profanasaurus.
Hentai. Various. Depending on spelling, either a form of Japanese erotic artwork, or a brand of niche pornography involving poultry in bondage. Either way, not a word to type into Google Images while at work, unless you want the sack.
Oh, thank you very much for that, Jim. Hentai, yeah.
Always a pleasure.
Thank you very much. Tip your waitress. Try the veal. Right, okay. And you can hear Jim on Hypnobobs doing a fantastic second part, not the final part, second part, which is a tribute to Richard Matheson, which you can find on iTunes, geekplanetonline.com. And at hypnagoria.com, and he's got various publications around the universe.
Hurrah!
Hurrah! Anyway, we'll hear more from him later on in the show. Right, well, I suppose we better move on and get a bit of Akira!
Tetsu!
Kaneko!
Think back to the films you remember as good, ones you haven't viewed in a while. How the story rocked and the actors were great, the camera work had flair and style. What would happen now if you watched them today? Are they still as fresh as before? Or do they stink as bad as a piss-covered tramp and leave you screaming on the floor? You know it can be real sad. Find that special film is bad. Wish you just left it a pleasant memory. Now it's time for rose tinted specs on Black Dog. Watching movies from the past you thought were great. Yes, it's time for rose tinted specs on Black Dog. Send your feedback in and tell us how they rate.
Ah, Akira. Right, okay, so now I'm going to absolutely fuck all these pronunciations, so let's just battle through this and pretend I'm not trying to be racist. I don't mean pretend I'm not trying to be racist. I'm not being racist. What am I talking about? Right, okay, so Akira, directed by Kishiro Otomo, screenplay by Kishiro Otomo and Izo Hashimoto, based on Akira by Kishiro Otomo. I'm doing quite well at the moment.
Doing very well.
Yes, released by TMS and Entertainment and distributed by Toho, who did the Godzilla films. It was released on the 16th of July, 1988, which would have been 25 years ago last Tuesday. But we were doing fucking Bugsy Malone instead. it had a budget of $11
million. I like you did. It had a budget.
Yes, it had a budget. And that's that. And thank you very much for listening. Good night. Yeah, it had a budget of $11 million and made back at the box office $123 million. Worldwide.
Wow.
So it didn't do too bad.
No.
Especially considering that was back in 1988. And it didn't even get a release over in the UK, a full cinema release, until 1991. It got a limited release at the ICA and the Scala Cinema in 1988.
Yeah.
A little bit of news on the production. While working on the original manga Akira, creator Kishiro Otomo agreed to do an anime adaptation of the series, provided he retained complete creative control. This instance was based on his experience working on Harmageddon. The Akira Committee was the name given to the partnership for several major Japanese entertainment companies brought together to realise the production of an Akira film. The group's assembly was necessitated by the unconventionally high budget, which was 1.1 billion yen, which is about 11 million.
Pence.
Yeah, 11 pence. That much money was intended to achieve the desired epic equal a standard equal to Otomo's over 2,000-page manga tale. The committee considered the publisher Kushinda Limited and consisted of Kushinda Limited, Machinity Broadcasting, and Bandai, Haduko Incorporated, Toho and Laserdisc Corporation, and Sumonatro Corporation. Oh, for fuck's sake. Most anime is notorious for cutting production corners with limited animation, such as having only the characters' mouths move while their faces remain static. Akira broke this trend with its detailed scenes, pre-scored dialogue, wherein the dialogue is recorded before the film starts production, which was all a first for anime. The superfluid motion was realized in the film's more than 160,000 animation cells. Unlike its live-action predecessors, Akira also had a budget to show a fully realized futuristic Tokyo. The teaser trailer for Akira was released in 1987, and the film was completed and released in 1988, 2 years before the manga itself officially ended in 1990. I know that because I was trying to get the last three fucking episodes for almost a year. But anyway, Otomo had great difficulty in completing the manga itself. He has stated that the inspiration for the conclusion arose from a conversation he had with Angelo Jajowski in 1990. Otomo later recalled that the film project had begun with the writing of the ending that would be suitable for a closure of the major characters' storylines and themes without being extraordinarily lengthy, so that he could know in reverse order which manga elements would be cut out and put back into the anime, and thus suitably resolve the manga's various elements to a lean 2-hour story. Otomo is a big fan of Tenjin 28 Go. I don't know what that is, but apparently it's relevant. As a result, his naming convention matches the characters featured in Tenjin 28 Go. Kaneda shares his name with the protagonist of Tenjin 28 Go. Colonel Shikamisha shares his name with Professor Shikamisha of Tenjin 28 Go, while Tetsu is named after Shikamisha's son, Tetsu Shikamisha. Akira's Ryosaku is named after Ryosaku Murami. And in addition, Takashi has the 26 tattooed on his hand, which closely resembles the font of Tenjin 28 Go. The namesake of the series, Akira, is the 28th in line of psychics that the government had developed. The sound of Canada's bike engine was produced by compositing the engine sound of a 1929 Harley Davidson motorcycle with a jet engine.
Wow.
Akira was released by Toho in 1988. The film set an attendance record for an animated film in Japan. Fledgling North America distribution company Streamline Pictures soon acquired an existing English language rendition created by Kushinda, which saw a limited release in North America in late 1988 through to 89. Streamline is reported to become the film's distributor when both George Lucas and Steven Spielberg labelled it unremarkable in the US. Unmarketable in the US. In the UK, Akira was theatrically released by ICA and was re-released in July 2013. That's pretty much just release dates then. Roger Ebert selected Akira as his video pick of the week in 1989 in Siskel and Ebert at the Movies. For its wider 2001 release, he gave the film a thumbs up. As of April 2012, the film has a 90% fresh rating on Rotten Tomatoes. The title has been regarded as one of the greatest animated movies of all time and prompted an increase in popularity in anime movies in the US and generally outside of Japan. It's still admired for its exceptional visuals. Channel 4's 2005 poll of the 100 greatest cartoons of all time, featuring both cartoon shows and cartoon movies, Akira came in at number 16. Empire magazine listed it on one of its 500 greatest movies of all time. Akira is number 440. It showed again on Empire's list of 100 best films of world cinema in at 51. Akira is regarded by many critics as a landmark anime film, one that influenced much of the art of the anime style, and its release with many of its illustrations in the manga industry, citing the film as an important influence. Akira has been cited as a major influence on live-action films ranging from Matrix to Chronicle. Akira Anime also made Time Magazine's number top five animated DVDs. I'll leave it there because it just goes on and on and on. There was a rumour that they were going to make an animated live-action film, which was going to star Keira Knightley, Helena Bonham Carter, Gary Oldman, and then Ken Watanabe. But luckily, thanks to whatever gods of fate exist, that got shut down. So, that's as good as it's going to get.
Long-held nightmare.
Yes, exactly. No! Exactly. An extended scream in Bastards. My brain. So, Darren, go on in. Hit me with it, because I will preface this by saying that when we went to see it together at the Scarlet,
many thousands of years ago,
and you weren't nearly that impressed.
Yeah, I to try and give you some perspective, it's always been the last sort of like 10 minutes of this film that kind of pissed me off. It's kind of like, what the fuck are you doing? You've just given us all this, and now you're doing this.
Yeah,
and I have to say, on the second viewing,
is this only the second time you've ever seen it?
I think it is possibly the second time I've ever seen it. It might be the third time, actually. But it is a much better film than I remember it being. And also, the last bit at the end now makes total sense. I've now kind of sat and watched it all through and really enjoyed it. Even if they do shout at each other quite a bit at the most inappropriate moments.
Yes.
Laura's never seen it before, and she really liked it as well.
Right.
But she had the same complaint about the shouty bits.
Yes, yes.
So, the animation itself, it's really well done. There are some moments there where it's just so smooth, some of the stuff that goes on, where you can see they've taken their time with it. There are certain bits of the soundtrack that I really like. It's when that one tune that always stays with me when that film is concerned is the theme tune for the Cloud Gang Leader.
Oh.
Or the Clown Gang Leader. Oh. Yeah. That fucking brilliant piece of music for him.
Yeah.
And he's like riding down the road, he's got his arms crossed, you know, he's like, like steering the bike. Just
like he's riding a sofa in it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So little bits like that. Yeah, the action's good in it. It's just a really good film. It's a really... I don't really like... I'm not really a big fan of anime.
No, me neither.
Yeah, I think they can just go off on so many tangents and all of a sudden everybody's got superpowers and, you know, it's what saves the day. You know, it goes all Power Rangers.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, whereas this one, it doesn't give you anything unexpected. It doesn't suddenly have Ryu growing a pair of wings and... Oh, not Ryu. What am I talking about?
There is a Ryu.
Yes, there is.
Golden moustache. Yeah.
Sorry,
Canada
growing a pair of wings and spouting some sort of special power wand or something like this.
Yeah.
No, what you see is what you get with these characters.
Yeah.
You know, I thought it was cohesive. It actually told a proper story. In general, and what a cool bike.
Yeah, you can't go wrong with that bike.
You can't go wrong with that bike.
I have actually seen
a
live action version of that bike.
Oh, you have?
Yeah, someone drove it up Shaftesbury Avenue once.
Oh, blimey.
It's like, couldn't turn corners for shit.
No, I bet it couldn't.
Because it was just like a rigid lump.
It's still a nice bike.
Did look nice, yeah. But, cool, so...
it definitely gets the thumbs up from me.
Right, and was there nothing that bothered you? I mean, obviously the shouty bit is obviously something.
Well, no, it's more comical than anything else. It's like shouting at really inappropriate moments. So it's like there's a little bit of comedy there, you know?
Yeah.
But it's like I love Canada's unrelenting sense that even though this is a super being I'm going up against, I'm going to fuck it up.
He's
like, he's the typical sort of kid, you know, gang member.
Yeah.
This is it.
Yeah,
you may be a god, but I'm going to fuck you with my laser gun.
Yeah, I'm going to do some funky ass driving and shoot you with my laser from a distance.
Yep. I'm going to take you down to Chinatown. That's what I'm going to do.
Exactly. Racist.
Well, no, it's a phrase.
I'm joking.
Robert De Niro uses it.
Yeah. So, did you not... So this time round, you didn't have a problem with the end?
I didn't have a problem with the end at all because I got what it was about.
Mm.
I got the fact that you had three sets of memories played out there.
Mm.
You had Tetsu's,
mm.
you had Candida's, and you also had Akira's
mm.
as well.
And the three kids as well later on. As the explosion grows, you get the three kids as well.
Oh, of course, because they get inside the explosion. Yeah. I felt very sorry for Canada, for Tetsu's girlfriend, who doesn't okay. seem to have anything nice happen to her, especially at the end of the film, when she gets completely squished.
Yes.
So it's like a rounding off to her. You know, it's like putting the pickle on the fucking shit sandwich. You know, that's it. There you go. It's your pickle. It's your dill pickle. Oh, I'm sorry. It's gone off. But, well, fucking eat it anyway. You're eating a shit sandwich. Yeah. What does it matter?
Yeah, it was quite grim in that respect.
Yeah.
It
was. That was quite, I mean, how she gets treated and punched in the face and the top ripped off and stuff like this. It's all very uncomfortable.
Yeah. I must admit, it's hard for me to sort of evaluate this film without sort of like constantly having the six books in the back of my mind.
Mm.
Because the one thing that jibes with me with this film, and I will say this now, is especially this time around watching it, is it seems like Tetsu goes right off the rails in a matter of seconds. He goes from a wimp to being tested on to fucking everyone's going to get a fucking piece of psychic sandwich.
I think that's more to do with the medication that they put him on, and they start doing things with his brain, and it's obviously unlocking some part of his personality that he's never accessed before, which is the bit with the backbone.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and he does actually say anyway, it's like, you know, tells Canada to stop rescuing him.
Yeah, that I get. And then when you get the whole flashback thing, that makes perfect sense.
Mm.
I think it's just the fact that all of a sudden he just grows a pair, and then suddenly he's going to take Corey off. He's going to take Corey and he's going to nick Canada's bike, and then he's going to go off and he's just going to drive away. And it's suddenly just like, it's like, oh, right. And then 2 seconds later, he's like, all angry and, you've saved me again. And it's just like, yeah, kick the mics down.
I'll kick the mics down.
And it just seems like that was the only thing this time round. I found it a bit like, oh, he suddenly goes from, you know, wimp to warrior with little or no transition. And I have to say that, you know, back in the books, you know, he does take like, well, he would take what would have probably be the equivalent of like 60 minutes of runtime to slowly go down that road.
Blimey.
Yeah. But no, I have to say, I watched it this time around and I was fully expecting to... I don't know. I've seen this film so many times that I kind of expected to kind of go a bit...
Yeah.
...the other way. And at one point, I nearly did. But that was because I was kind
Which
of
Which point
like,
was that?
It was quite early on. It was quite early on, but I found the scientist bit when he's sort of matching up Akira's brainwave patterns and all that kind of stuff. It all just felt a bit rushed.
Right. Okay.
You know, because it suddenly goes from like that little toady guy. He's paying for Ryu's, you know, equipment and it didn't seem to be any reason or rhyme for them to sort of rescue the kids. And it was just like, oh, okay, fine. You don't know why you're rescuing the kids, and you don't know why what this toady guy is getting out of it. Once the colonel just declares martial law and it all kicks off, yeah, fine, we're back on it. But I think the whole political machinations bit is kind of a bit undercooked.
Well, maybe it's because I'm a Londoner. No, maybe maybe it's because there are large chunks of the whole story missing
Yeah, absolutely. You know? I mean, there's the uprising. There's a whole bunch of, you know, there's never really an explanation of what the revolution's about. There's no explanation about what they're fighting against. And there's no explanation why Kei and Ryu are actually trying to steal these kids. You know, what they're actually expecting to do with them. There's no idea. And then there's that, like I say, that little toady guy with the fucking... moustache with the heart pills.
Oh, him. Yeah.
And in the books, he's got quite a big arc. But the thing is, in this, he just seems like all he's doing is he's on the council and he's just fucking about. Yeah, here's some money. Go fuck up this guy's day, and then
go fuck him up.
Yeah, and then 5 minutes later, you've started a revolution, which is what I was paying you guys to help start, and you've actually started it, and now all of a sudden, now I've got to get out of town. Yeah.
Oh, it's shit, like, I've got to pay you now.
Exactly, and that was the only thing that kind of bugged me a little bit, because it's that whole political bit was just a bit undercooked. But otherwise, I thought it was amazing. I mean, the bike chases. And,
it's always good to see.
And the visuals. I mean, I tell you the bit of animation that really always really makes me go, wow.
Yeah.
It's actually that bit right at the beginning when the guy with a cheese cutter, and he's got Takashi by the hand, and he goes in front of that police blockade, and they basically rip him to pieces with a hail of bullets.
Oh, yeah.
And he just goes, and it's like... Yeah. He's like, fucking hell.
That is a bit rough.
That's when you suddenly realise that this is no easy ride. But, yeah. I mean, like I say, we're running a bit long and you're starting to nod.
I'm flagging.
You are flagging.
Yeah. It's been a long week and it's only Tuesday.
It's been a long road. So what I'll do is I'll wrap this up by basically, before we go to feedback, but basically just to say that I think this film... is as good now as ever, and unlike some manga, it hasn't dated. I don't think it's dated at all.
No.
And like unlike most manga that I watch, it isn't just crazy bonkers for the fucking hell of it.
No, it isn't.
Because I tell you, that's the worst thing, right? I know there's cultural differences with manga.
Yeah.
And I know there's things that you just won't get in the translation, but... To me, and I apologise for any generalisation because I know I'm going to get... There's some manga lovers in the crowd out there. But to me, it just feels like what they do is they go, right, okay, we've got a good story. Hang about. We're 25 minutes in and crazy shit hasn't happened. I know. Let's have a demon with a 6,000-mile-long penis smash a fucking hospital to death. And, you know, and... Dress it up all you like. A lot of manga is basically was it Tim Bisley calls Rocky Horror? Calls it boiling the bag perversion, isn't it?
Something like that, yeah.
Yeah. And basically it's the same thing. Everyone goes, oh no, Ghost in the Shell's really fucking deep. Yeah. But Ghost in the Shell's enduring image is a pre-teen nubile girl, stark bollock naked with a gun floating about. It's just like...
We'll have some of that.
Yeah, we'll have some of that. That's the thing. That's the one thing I appreciate with Akira, is it doesn't do the standard manga stuff. It doesn't go, ooh, wibble, about 15 minutes in, and then someone shows their cock, or everything turns into a big demon, or everyone starts talking in fucking... What was it? Fucking fortune cookies. Everyone, you find it, everything from Dragon Ball Z to fucking Evangelion, you'll have one scene with a character looking off to the left while some piss-poor fucking lens flares stream down on them from the top corner of the screen, and they go, to know oneself, someone must know you, or something like that.
That's what they naturally do anyway. So,
yeah, you know, it's just... and it's just all, you know, they'll just come out with something that just, you know, if you press 995 on your ATM, something good will happen. You know,
must control anger before anger controls you.
Yeah,
what
the Sphinx. The Sphinx from fucking Mystery Men. That whole... Most manga output is exactly that. Yeah, exactly. Yes.
Brilliant.
Yeah, before you can know oneself, one must know you.
There's an awful lot of pretentious manga out there.
Yeah, exactly. And then just as you're sitting there going, but what does that even mean? Then 16 characters will all look the same, will all start fighting.
Yeah.
And you're just like, why? Why? I don't understand. So the style, the look, the action, the pace, everything was like an actual film.
Wow.
As opposed to just a pile of old gibberish with an excuse for tits and Sailor Moon costumes.
Ooh.
There you go.
Well, there you go.
I'll get you awake by saying, I'll say tits.
Tits.
Wow.
It's like sugar to a wasp.
Anyway.
Woo. Cosplay nudity. What?
Yeah, exactly. Cosplay nudity. Oh, you're awake, Darren. So, yeah, I mean, overall, I didn't quite get the buzz of watching it this time round, but yeah. I've read the comics more now than I've seen the film, and I didn't appreciate some of the stuff they cut out, but I couldn't see how they'd do it any other way. So, like I say, it was as good as it was.
And yeah, I think they got enough in this. Yes.
I think overall it was very good.
It's one of those few animes that I would recommend to people. This one, Appleseed, I would definitely recommend that to people. Because right. I think that's quite no nonsense, that one.
Right.
What's the other two? There's also, Kiki's Delivery Service, which is actually quite a fun little film, and I think it's really good for kids.
Is that the one with the pig?
No, that's the one with the little cat. That one there. Spirited Away.
See, I haven't seen that.
That's good. That's a good film. That's really, really good. A lot of fun.
But, yeah, okay, fair enough.
Yeah. So, there's very few I recommend. I don't really get into things like the Ninja Scrolls and stuff like that. It's all very...
Fuck.
No, thanks.
No, not really. You know? Not my thing. I was going to say, there's not a lot of manga I really enjoy. I watch it, and I appreciate the art style, but yeah. The rest of it, I'm just like, oh, fuck. Anyway, right. Let's move on to some feedback. I thought Akira was fantastic, so let's just
leave
it
there. Yeah, same here. And great film.
Yes, total thumbs up for me.
Yep, and me too.
Right, okay, shall we share the feedback to keep you awake?
Or let's share the feedback to keep me awake, Lee.
Right, okay, well, I'll first off...
Read it from the garden so I'm outside so it's nice and cool? Shout it in.
I'll start off with some feedback.
Go on, then.
Which is mysterious, to say the least.
Why has it not been named?
Well, it has been named. It's been named as Captain Inappropriate.
Do we know who this Captain Inappropriate is?
I have no idea who Captain Inappropriate is. I checked
Tracy IP address.
No. So, I'll read you what Captain Inappropriate had to say. And, you know, Captain Inappropriate, if you would like to reveal yourselves to us, that's fine. Or if you want to carry on sending in feedback as Captain Inappropriate, by all means do so.
It's going to be like the Phantom of the Opera. He's going to reveal himself and dive.
It is I, Leclerc. Or
she's going to dive. It could be anybody.
It could be anyone.
Yes.
Well, I'll read you out and you tell me whether or not you think it's male or female.
All right, then, got him.
So, Captain Inappropriate writes, "Esteemed gentlemen of the Black Dog, I am not the feedbacker hero the Black Dog needs. I'm certainly not the feedbacker hero the Black Dog deserves. I'm probably not even the feedback hero the Black Dog wants. You may chase me. You may hunt me. You may even ignore my feedback. I can take it. Actually, I can't take it. I'm really quite ashamed of myself. That's why I wear a mask. You merely adopt the gutter. I was born in it. I am Captain Inappropriate." All in capitals, that bit.
Who is Captain Inappropriate?
But enough of the introductions. It is time I gave my thoughts on the film you have generously chosen for our perusal. Kashiro Otomo's magnum opus, Akira. My take is this. Thrilling, but not nearly as much fun to fap to as Bugsy Malone.
What? Hold on. I call Captain Inappropriate to be Danny Graydon.
I don't know.
That's who that is.
Anyway, so yeah, thrilling but not nearly as much fun to fap to as Bugsy Malone. Genuflex spreads his cheeks. What's this? Oh, God, the bloody iPad's gone off. Genuflex spreads his cheeks and takes off to the sound of a thunderous fart. Captain Inappropriate. So... thank you so much, Captain Inappropriate. And, yes. Yeah, he is called Super Inappropriate Man.
Is he?
Apparently, on his email. So, I won't give you the domain name so that you don't know. No one can start sending him weird emails. But, thank you very much for that. And, we look forward to hearing more of Captain Inappropriate.
Danny Graydon.
I don't know. I don't think he is. If it was Danny Graydon, there'd be about 1,000 times more, yeah. I would have thought. But anyway, there you go. So the next piece of feedback is from Elton McManus of the Shonky Lab, who is currently on holiday, so you can rob his house.
Mm. Yes.
Darren.
I'm round there right now. I'm doing a live broadcast from Elton's living room. he goes, so Elton writes, hi, guys.
Hello.
I watched the Japanese version of Akira shortly after you announced you were rose-tinting it the first time round and thoroughly enjoyed it. Mm-hmm. I did happen to watch the American version years ago when it was on Channel 4 late one night.
Yeah.
It was after a jolly good drink up at the pub, and I must admit, it confused me somewhat. Nothing to do with the pre-beer warm-up, of course. More to do with the fact that I kept dozing off. I know that feeling well. Anyway, Akira looks flipping amazing, dirty and gritty, and inevitable about inevitability about it. I flipping loved it so much that I will be borrowing off the internet again in the future. All the best, chaps, and keep up the great work, Elton. Thank you very much, Elton.
Thank you, Elton. And yes, Elton is one half of the Shonky Lab, which you can find at shonkylab.co.uk. Yeah, he does the podcast with Pete. And next, when they return, they'll be doing facts.
Facts?
Yes. So if you have any facts, send in your previously unknown fact to shonkylab@gmail.com. There you go. Right. Okay, next piece of feedback is from Martin Thompson. And Martin writes, hello, Black Doggers. This is the second time I've seen the Akira, although the first time I've seen it with an American dub. I'm not really a fan of anime. The style just seems to get on my nerves. I guess it's like disliking Disney. And I know I'm condemning a whole genre here, but it's just something I've never really gotten into. Anyway, Akira and I enjoyed it, and I thought it more than I thought I would. The mystery of who or what Akira is played out well, but those grey-skinned kids gave me the creeps. At least the fat Sam from Bugsy Malone is still getting some work. A lot of body horror near the end with Tetsu turning into a huge blob of something. I can't say I cared for the central characters either. Kaneda and Tetsuo were a couple of pricks. I know what you mean about Idris Elba playing the Colonel, though. He would be a great choice if they did a live-action remake.
Exactly.
Absolutely. Anyway, enjoyable enough, and I appreciate its place in cinematic history. It's just not quite my thing. Cheers, Martin.
Cheers, Martin.
I think that's fair enough.
Hmm.
I mean, I have been quite defensive about it on the Facebook group, I'll be honest with you. But that's because, again, I think it's one of those films where, you know, okay, we've got to evaluate it roasting its spec style, haven't we? So we've got to watch it again.
Exactly.
But if you're going to talk about it and dismiss it, and, like, you know, we had Ollie who wasn't going to watch it again, and Michael G. Cock who just seems to be pressing the "I don't like it, let's make Lee twitch" button, you know, or
electric shock,
exactly, or Hunter as well, Hunter Langley,
yes,
you know, who's saying he wasn't liking it, and that's fine, but don't sit there and go, "I'm not going to watch it, I don't like it." But I think films that came after it were better. It's like, well, hold on. So you're saying you're not going to watch it, you're not going to evaluate it, but you're going to dismiss it, given that it actually gave rise to all the things that you liked.
He's saying that Grown Ups 2 is better than Akira, then.
Who said that?
Well, obviously, yes. He said all the films that come after it. Is he meaning in general?
No. He was talking about Manga.
Oh, right. Okay. Manga. You'll say, because that's a pretty blanket statement there,
Mike. That would have me set him on fire with my power of my mind.
You like Sucker Punch. No.
But no, I mean, no, it's fair enough. I mean, if you don't like it, you don't want to watch it, that's fair enough. But I just, for my money, it's like, it has a place in cinematic history, and if you're going to reevaluate it, that's fine. You know, do it. Yeah. But don't dismiss it out of hand if you're not going to watch it again.
No.
Because I may find, like Mr. Barnard over here, you may actually find you like it.
Yeah.
Or at least appreciate it.
I think it's because I've had a proper watch of it and, you know, sat down, actually concentrated on it, followed it through, and really enjoyed it.
Mm. But anyway, but you know what? If you choose not to get involved, that's fine. I'm not having a go at anyone. I'm just, don't have a go at my bloody film.
Yeah.
No. Don't fuck it. It's been a long night. I don't know what I'm talking about. Anyway. I'll tell you what.
Yep.
You can have the last piece of written feedback.
Okay.
before we get onto MP3.
It's an 8-page Opus Magnus by Jeppy Starro, isn't it? Yes.
Yay!
I may fucking do it. I've just seen the title of the mail. Okay, so Jack writes, Tetsu, you can't! Okay, so any feedback that leads with, I really don't want to say I'm racist, but it's never off to a good start, is it?
No.
Well, it's just that it's pretty hard for me not to discuss, pretty hard for me to discuss Akira without kind of addressing Japan. See, I think it's perfectly possible and valid to have opinions and issues with the culture without having remotely any feelings of racial antipathy, was it?
I don't know, antipathy.
Antipathy, sorry, my apologies. It's just that it's rather a difficult hair for some people to split when the vast majority of the culture in question are made up of specific ethnicity. Blimey, that was a big word. And likewise, most people of the racial type are going to be... it's one of those words I can't pronounce.
Mm.
My tongue gets all tied up. That'll be the next line in a Darren Diamond song. You want?
I'll put it in there deliberately.
Yeah, I bet you fucking will. fast real culture. Sorry. So, unlike talking about peccadilloes of English. Peccadilloes? Did I say that right? I probably didn't. Versus French or African-American versus South America cultures. It's very dicey to voice unflattering opinions of Japanese culture that sounding like you're some kind of racist. Now, Akira was kind of significant in that regard for me. I grew up loving Western adapted versions of a lot of things. I didn't always consciously recognise as Japan in origin, like the ninjas, giant robots, Godzilla and sushi, while conversely having a grandfather who fought in the Pacific theatre of World War II and saw Japanese war atrocities firsthand, which was a much more specific idea about their culture implanted in my young head. With this acknowledged bias, I have come to have reservations about a lot of aspects of Japanese culture in terms of ethical outlook, gender politics, politics, individualism, their own racial politics, and so forth.
Then you again, will. Keep going.
Yeah, I am. I'm trying to keep up there. Then again, one of our oldest family friends is Japanese and culturally very much so. Are you getting the ambivalence message yet? Anyway, Akira was the first anime feature film I ever saw and was the first strong awareness I had of the vast cultural differences that come across narratively in terms of characterization, themes and dramatic presentation. Perhaps it's a cliche, but as someone who pretty much turned off by most anime, this Ghost in the Shell and the films of Miyazaki are pretty much the only things on my rather short list of anime I can stand. Indeed, even Pacific Rim, which I found enjoyable on the whole, was disappointing to me in that it was much less of an original
Guillermo.
There'll be a short intermission. Take on the genre than I expected. And for me, it was a count against it that it displayed an almost checklist usage of tropes that were familiar to me from Neon Genesis Evangelion, the only anime series that I ever managed to get through and hugely regret doing so. So, rewatching Akira wasn't a great idea for me. I still think it's a good movie and a beautifully animated one, but the things I noticed as culturally irritating and alienating that first time and a couple since have now magnified. The emphasis on phantasmagorical, mutilating techno-gore, nihilism, anti-heroes, I failed to find tragic, especially angsty teenage protagonists and their obtusely esoteric endings are all front and centre. Those last two things being Pacific Rim mercifully dodged, and they really annoy me. The world building is amazing, however, and the tech animation is Pavlovian to me. I want Canada's fucking bike. Yes, don't we all? Okay, that's enough rambling. No more anime, please, unless it's Spirited Away. see Spirited Away.
Well, you won't be getting Spirited Away.
No?
Any whimsical old bollocks is just not my thing.
Okay. All the best news, gents. From my hotel in Singapore, but actually now Germany.
Now Germany, yeah.
Jack. Well, thank you very much for that, Jack.
Thank you, Jack.
Yes.
And actually, before we go on to MP3,
yep,
we have some Facebook.
Oh, okay,
because,
go for it.
I won't pronounce her surname because she says when I do it, it sounds like puke. But Lisa K.
Yeah.
Of
Lisa
South-
K. She's got a rapper's name now.
Yeah, Lisa K.
Yeah.
Yo,
give
Lisa
it the gang
K.
Sign, man.
Lisa K of South Africa, yo. basically, she wrote, she got to see Akira because I was kind of interested to see what she, because she'd never seen it before.
Yeah.
And she wrote, this is purely a Facebook sort of back and forth, so it's not quite a feedback, but there you go. Anime always delivers good gore. So far, there's been a lot of politics, an English dub that was instantly switched to Japanese, and subtitles. Weird little old kids and some dude tripping balls. Oh, and there's some titties and a weird rapey vibe. Ooh, classic Japan. So I said, oh, that's the film. So she goes, sure, why wouldn't he be able to breathe in outer space? So I said, oh, I refer you to Book of Blackdog, chapter 1, verse 1, page 1. Shut up, that's why. So she goes, shut up, that's why. Something tells me that I'm supposed to like this film for some reason, but I'm not feeling it. It's dragged out as fudge, and I still don't know why the kids looked old. Maybe I missed something or other, but it doesn't matter. Started out pretty cool. It was entertaining for the most part, but it got a little bit Dragon Ball Z along the way. And let's face it, it's as weird as Botox balls. a round of mares from me. Not bad, just not my thing. But what do I know? I watched two Disney classics earlier, and I'm still expecting characters to break into song every 5 minutes. So there you go. And Gareth Noel.
Because he knows all.
I don't know. Noel. Oh, fucking hell. Gareth, he writes, does the Bunker of Shun have aircon? If it does, then I'd just like to say Akira is shit and not a patch on the Phantom Menace. To which I informed him it didn't even have windows and no fridge.
No.
Get in there. Right. So anyway, so that's the written feedback, or at least as much as I know until I look on my
That's
email.
When you press finish on this, you'll find you've got another 15 pieces. That's what it'll
exactly.
be.
Exactly. But we've got some MP3 feedback. Now, the first piece of MP3 feedback, and we got quite a bit of it, is from Dave Jacola of the Inside Outcast. The Inside Outcast has just celebrated its 200th episode. So congratulations from us to them.
Yes, very much so. Golf clap.
Yes, golf clap.
Hey.
And basically, they're doing a roast, which is a kind of an American tradition of ripping the piss. Mm-hmm. However, I did decline on both of our behalves because I felt that if we started ripping the piss, we would probably stray over from lighthearted into just being mean-spirited to get a laugh.
There are issues in both our lives where this may make this turn out a bit.
Exactly.
Sort of.
It could go completely wrong. So anyway, but I'm sure other people have contributed, in which case go and listen to it on Geek Planet Online or iTunes. Mm. But anyway, let's move on and hear what Dave has to say about Akira.
Now presenting Bullshit Analysis with Dr. Dave. Speaking about a film you love proves most difficult as one struggles to articulate just what makes it so appealing. Akira is one such film. While some are quick to point out how it fails to live up to the manga, that it would take a trilogy of films to do the story justice, I have to say that however valid that argument may be, I just don't care. I am more than happy to get a condensed and self-contained story in just 2 hours and change. Otomo's adaptation makes economic cuts, painting characters in broad strokes, and giving just enough backstory that an attentive viewer's imagination fills in the rest. It is a challenging and complex film, but not without entertainment value. There is action, romance, horror, and comedy. It is an onion of a film offering several layers for the viewer to explore. At once, it is an account of 1980s Japan, of student rebellion and economic crises best exemplified as an unused Olympic stadium. It is Japan still struggling to come to terms with the horrors of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, much how toppling skyscrapers in current American cinema belie our struggling with the aftermath of 9/11. It is a parable of Japan's relations with North America, illustrated by the complex friendship and rivalry between Tetsuo's inferiority complex and Kaneda's brash and brazen attitude. It is a shining example of thoughtful science fiction, a tale that explores the dangers of an ethical experimentation, experiments to develop the psychic power in children. It is an exploration of life itself, the tapping into the vital energy in so small a species as an amoeba to the dynamic creative power of the Big Bang. One may even regard Tetsuo's story as a Buddhist allegory of a human being so attached to physical objects, in this instance Kaneda's bike, and his own fragile ego, that he is unaware of the dangers he poses to himself and others, especially those he holds most dear. He falls into a pattern of bad behavior, trapped in a wheel of misfortune. It takes an enlightened being, a Buddhist saint or bodhisattva in the form of Akira, to lead Tetsuo out of the destructive cycle by abandoning his physical form. He ascends, but he does not transcend. For despite Akira's efforts to guide the boy from his selfish path, the young man still clings to his ego with the affirmation, "I am Tetsuo." And that is my bullshit analysis.
Thank you very much for that, Dave.
Yeah, cheers, Dave.
Very good. And, yeah, once again, I'm listening to that and I'm thinking, shit, I should be talking about this. This is the kind of stuff I should be putting in there. It's like, bloody, I'm the fan. All we kind of did was, yeah, I liked it.
What do you think? Yeah, it's great.
Yeah, it's great. I mean, yeah, the whole American allegory, the Japan-American relations, the fallout from Hiroshima, all of those things are there. Though I have to say, and Dave did kind of briefly touch on it, sort of like with the whole, you know, you could make this a lot longer, but you get what you get in a condensed form. I have to say that I think, unfortunately, because I have read the manga so much, that I really miss certain threads, like the Americans themselves coming in to sort of try and you know, impose their imperialism upon Neo Tokyo again when they see the explosion, they see the second explosion then come in. There's lots and lots of stuff. If anyone's interested in the film, then definitely seek out the books, because it's a far, far deeper thing. The student rebellions, for example, as we mentioned before, we didn't really get from the film what's going on. It's just kind of like there's riots, there's discontent. That's the end of it. Whereas in the books, it's like it's literally like almost an ongoing theme throughout all six. What I was going to say, there's another thing Dave touched on that was really cool. The disused Olympics, disused Olympic thing. The fact that, you know, in the same way that Akira deals with, like, you know, Hiroshima, and it's like that whole thing of like, yeah, this is what American cinema's going through again with 9/11. Mm-hmm. You know, doing the same thing. It's just really interesting to kind of draw that parallel, you know, that at some stage there's going to come a sort of like movie that might just kind of deal with that once and for all in a way that isn't going to just be constantly showing a building falling over all the time.
Yeah.
But anyway, the lot to chew over there, Dave. Thank you very much for that. Really good feedback as ever. And like I say, if you want to listen to more of Dave's far more intelligent kind of conversation than our gibberish, then go over to the geekplanetonline.com or go onto iTunes and search out the Inside Outcast. Right, okay, well, next piece of feedback comes from Justin Pearson Smith. Now, I haven't listened to this, I'll be honest with you straight away, but I will say that when Justin first tried to watch Akira, he watched the American dub, and I kind of said on Facebook, don't do that. Watch a Japanese dub, Japanese subtitles, because you may get more out of it. Now, I don't know if that's going to have any relation to this, but I just thought I'd mention that now, just in case he brings it up. Okay. Anyway, let's listen to what Justin has to say about Akira.
Hey, hi guys, I just thought I'd send in some quick feedback for Akira. I first saw Akira as my introduction to anime when I was in my late teens, probably about 16, 17, something like that. And there was a magazine called Mean Machines, which is a UK publication. It was basically a video games magazine. And they did a special on anime. And one of the films which they mentioned was Akira. So I picked it up from the video store, put it in, and was blown away by it. And this was, unfortunately, the dub of Akira. And many years later, actually last year, I, for the first time, finally got around to reading the manga, what the film is based on, and I loved that. And it's so completely different. And, yeah, I mean, there's little things like big characters in the film, such as that priest woman who's going on about Akira. She's actually a really significant character in the manga. And, yeah, I mean, this time I watched the film subbed, and, yeah, it's a lot easier to follow subtitled because the translation is so much better. I really, really enjoyed watching it. The ending made a lot more sense, though I'm not sure if that's because I've seen the film about 6 or 7 times and now read the manga as well, or if it's just because I'm older. It's still a fantastic film. There's so much political commentary through it, social commentary, so many philosophical ideas and concepts. It's just a thinking person's anime, and it's still one of the best anime films of all time. It's one of the best animated films in terms of cell animation. And I remember when I first watched it, I actually showed some of it to my dad, and for him, at the time, the pinnacle of animation was the Transformers cartoon from the 80s. And he said, yeah, well, that's finally knocked off Transformers the movie as the best animated film as far as he'd seen. Keeping in mind, he didn't really get out that much to watch animated films. Anyway, that's it for now. I'll see you guys later. Bye.
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 It seems like I misrepresented him at the beginning, saying that he didn't like it. I must have just misremembered that. But anyway, thank you very much for that, Justin. And obviously, yeah, the priestess doing all the soothsaying who gets squashed in the bridge, she, in the comic, she is like a major character, like a Yoda figure. Her name is Lady Mako, and she is actually, and the thing that kind of they allude to by a look in the comic, and well, rather in the film, is that she's actually one of the test subjects. She's actually one of the earlier test subjects. And so then, and that's what I was saying earlier, when we didn't really get a reason why Kay and Ryu and that guy who gets shot up at the crossing were trying to steal Takashi while they were trying to rescue him. It's because in the comics, they're taking the subjects, the people that they rescue, to Lady Mako. And basically, she is one of the early test subjects who did escape and basically weaned herself off of the drugs that were causing the psychic powers. But she learned to control the psychic powers with what she got. So she was actually, like I say, like a Yoda, kind of hidden out in plain sight, but training up new Jedi, for want of a better term. And so that was the thing. She had like a whole Buddhist temple of psychic children who had been rescued from the Colonel and who had been weaned off the drugs and learnt to control their powers. And that whole element was really fundamental as to why that whole thing of stealing the kids at the beginning was important. And it kind of, that was the only thing I kind of got a bit miffed with once I'd read the manga again, that it came out.
Yeah.
And it's just like, oh, that's why. But instead, she's relegated to being a crazy person on a bridge.
Yeah.
That's essentially it.
Just that.
Yeah. Anyway, thank you very much for that, Justin. And yes, it is a fantastic, fantastic film. Right, now, moving on. We move on to another friend of ours who's doing a fantastic podcast, which I've been listening to and not without some irony, given the subject they were covering this week. It is Sean McGowan of the Question podcast, which if you're not listening to, you should. You can find Sean and his wife, Melissa, answering various questions about life, the universe and everything on the Question podcast, which you can find at thequestionpodcast.com. Anyway, he managed to get the feedback in right under the door, and let's hear what he thought of Akira.
Hey, Lee and Darren, it's Sean, and I am here to give some feedback on Akira, or Akira, as it's said in the film. It's my first time seeing the film. I've seen pieces of it, and I've been familiar with the story for years, but this is the first time actually sitting and watching the whole film, and I have to say that I regret not having done sooner. I think it was an absolutely phenomenal film. And, it blew me away, no pun intended. Visually stunning. And that's even after 25 years. But to think about what it must have been like 25 years ago to see this film, I can understand why so many people, and you particularly, geek out over this film. I just was absolutely taken in by it. And I'll be honest, I'm one that often has a very difficult time with subtitles, because it's just, reading and keeping an eye on the action, it's usually a very distracting thing for me. But I just became so engrossed in it that I it was phenomenal. I just loved it, absolutely loved it. And I have to say, it kind of puts into mind something, a bit of a possible debate topic. I don't think that this film needs a live action version. And in fact, I think that it's an insult to the film, I think, to make it into a live action. I mean, even if the live action version was a good film, even if they did the original justice, I kind of think that this raises a philosophical argument of, is doing a live action film, does that kind of discount the power of animation? Does that basically say that animation isn't good enough on its own? Because certainly I think that this film I don't think of it as an animated film. I think that this is a brilliant film. It just happens to be animated. And I think that to make a live action film in some way diminishes, the art of animation, and in some way says that, animation isn't good enough, that it would require a live action counterpart. I mean, that's just my two cents. That's just the feeling I got from it, because I just thought that, there are many great animated films, but, like, you go see Despicable Me. It's a fun ride. It's a fun movie. And you can even argue it's a good movie, but you're watching a cartoon. Films like some of the Pixar films, let's take The Incredibles. That's a film that you watch, and even though it's animated, you don't think of it as being animated. You just enjoy it as a film. It kind of transcends the medium. Akira certainly transcended the medium, and I just think it was absolutely an amazing film, a compelling story. I can understand why people kind of get lost at the end, and I'm not going to sit here and pretend that I completely get it, but I kind of like the fact that I don't, because I'm going to go back and watch it again and try to interpret it. If I could take a shot in the dark, I basically would just say that Akira evolved past the physical form, and they basically, the three other children brought him back somehow, that they harnessed their energy to kind of summon him, and he was essentially, with his power, able to overtake Tetsu, who was evolving in his own way, kind of in a malformed way. And then at the end, they basically overtook him, or, Akira overtook him and kind of brought him into another dimension. And then if I am assuming from the credits that kind of look like reminiscent of the Big Bang, that basically they just birthed a whole different universe together. That's my initial take on it. I don't know if that's accurate. I don't know, whatever. But the bottom line is I don't, like, I understand why some people go, wait a minute, it went from kind of like action and stuff. And then this weird kind of, someone had described it to me that had seen it, that it kind of turned artsy at the end. And I don't think so. I think it stayed within the parameters of the story it intended to tell. I mean, I think the key to the story is when Kay and Canada are in the cell and she's explaining how, you know, man evolved from, you know, amoebas and up into reptiles and fish to apes and then to man, that, you know, it's all been all about energy. And I just think that, you know, what we saw at the end was the manifestation of the next level of evolution and of energy and basically going from human to becoming a piece of the universe. But anyway, one other real quick thing I'll say is that now having seen it, I can see how so many other films were influenced by it. I mean, the whole going from weakness to strength, that trope has been around forever, but I can see it now. I can see the fingerprints. I can see the fingerprints in a lot of, I don't know if Stephen King was influenced directly by this film, but I can look at a lot of Stephen King's work. And a lot of his stories go from, you know, deal with characters that go from being weak and having others protect them to turning on those, gaining power and then turning on those that would once protect them because, you know, that whole inferiority complex. And then once they gain power and strength, then they abuse it. I can see that. The most recent example I'd say is that film Chronicle, which I would say was probably heavily influenced by Akira. Akira. I want to make sure I pronounced that correctly. But anyway, I'm rambling now, so I'm going to end this. I just want to say, great film for what it's worth. The haters can suck it if they're out there. All right, enjoyed it. Thanks. Bye.
Thank you very much indeed for that, yeah. Sean. Lovely bit of feedback there. Do you? I mean,
it's nice to see it's getting love. You know,
yeah, from people. I didn't think he would. I'll be honest with you. I thought I was just setting myself up for a good punch up today.
It's like I said before. I think, you know, if it's the sort of thing I would introduce a person into manga with, I'd show him this.
And what do you think about Sean's point about a live action film? I mean, personally, I would never want to see a live action film. But do you think that even looking for a live action film undermines this one?
No, I don't. I don't think it would be dependent on how they did it. If they treated it with respect, if they got the right casting to do the roles, like, you know, as I said last week about Idris Elba being
the colonel.
I think he just suits that role down to ground. It is the colonel he's playing in Pacific Rim, as far as I'm concerned.
Pretty much,
you know, very very similar. He's got that form of presence around him. So I think if you get talented actors like Idris in there. To play the roles, and I think you should stick to their age as well, because there are an awful lot of kid actors there who are very, very good at what they do.
But I mean, yeah, but does that undermine the anime? I mean, because what Sean says, because it's like, is it sort of saying, well, yeah, that's a cartoon, let's make a real film now, because that is one of the things. It's like that. Akira itself, or Akira, I mean, there's so many different interpretations of how you pronounce that name now, but I'm going to go based on how they said it in the film. Akira is one of those films which, you know, I mean, to be quite honest, if it wasn't quite so garishly lit, I could have seen that as a sort of companion piece to Blade Runner.
Yeah.
And I just think, you know, that the fact that it's animated doesn't make neither a difference, neither here nor there. But do you think that that might be the attitude? It's a bit like sort of taking Old Boy and turning it into an American film. You know, you don't need to do it. You're not telling anyone any new story.
No,
you're just putting it in English.
I think what you've got to, the way you've got to look at it is, take into account that, say, like, the film that they make of this is great, and they've pushed all the right balance, ticked all the right boxes.
even though I know the companies that produce these things are only making of money, I personally think they do a lot of good in opening up a new section or a new audience to this, because there's a lot of people who won't watch anime, full stop, that's it.
No.
But if you present it in this form, then they get the story, the goodness, you know, they and it's important, because then maybe they might change their mind and go and watch it, or, you know, it's just the fact that it's got it out there and that...
Yeah, I mean, that is true. I mean, I did go back to watching other anime based off it, but I didn't hang around because it is a massive benchmark. I mean,
it is.
It's a bit like watching Star Wars and then going, oh well, actually I quite like science fiction, and then watching the humanoid with Richard Keel. It's like, fuck
the humanoid.
Off.
I went to the cinema to see that.
Yeah,
shit.
I know, me too. Fuck it out. But
I remember the adverts for that. Fuck a doodle doo. So yeah, I think a film version of this would open it up to the audience.
But would it undermine the original?
No. I think it would just... Well, as I say, it's got to be a good movie. If we're saying that it's good, then I don't think it will damage the anime at all. I don't think it draws anything.
Okay.
It wouldn't take anything away from it.
Mm.
It would, you know, it would just be another... It would just be the same thing in a different
another
form.
Interpretation
yeah,
of it.
But it would have to be a really good version of it for me to be satisfied with that.
Yeah, well, I mean, if you were ever to do a live action, and I truly touch wood, metal, everything for Micah, I genuinely wish they don't. I really don't want them to do it. But if they ever did, I'd like them to strike a mid ground between what we've seen on with the anime, and what's in the books, because the books are super dense. The anime, by comparison, is quite pared back. So make a six part series.
Yeah,
you know, which is, you know, I don't think unobtainable. No. I still wouldn't like to see it, and I personally would think it would undermine the anime, because it is that whole thing of, oh, it's in a different language, we'll make it for our language. And it kind of like, it's a bit like kind of a bit dismissive. That's how I'd view it. Because it's like, what are you gaining by remaking it?
Well, you know what, if you're going to talk about making it in a different language, they've already done that by you watching it with subtitles. You're not watching it in original Japanese.
No,
will in the world, you're looking at someone's interpretation of that.
No.
Which you would be if they read the script. It's just the same thing.
But then why is it the American dub seems... Because the thing with the subtitles...
Because the American dub is badly acted, but...
Yeah, but it's not just that, but it's also the fact that the American dub has to say things. You can read something quicker than you can actually say it. So a lot of that dialogue you're hearing is going, sort of doing a Japanese kind of... in your ears, and you're actually seeing it on the screen. And you're reading as fast as that thing is saying it. Whereas if someone had to say, pick a line, you know, it's something's happening. It's already here. It's already begun. Blah 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 blah. You know, the walls will fall and the Akira will return. By the time I've said that in that film, that scene has already passed. What I'm trying to say is to verbalize something always makes things a bit slower. That's why the acting's so shit in the English dub, because they're literally trying to cram it all into those 10 seconds when the dialogue actually is...
Yeah.
I mean, you know, when we do our intros, if I write something with, like, an extra four words in it, you're going to, like, no, I'm not cramming that in there. I'm not going to do that.
No.
It's like, same thing. And it's like, if you wanted to do a complete point-for-point adaptation, you couldn't. Because that's why the anime in English is so shit, because it's just like everyone's trying to do this.
But if you're doing if you're doing the acted version, you're not gonna have the trouble of fitting it all in. You are gonna have time to say those words.
But I'm just saying, going back to it, is that's why the subtitled version is actually different than watching a Japanese version pure, if you know what I mean. I think it's not changing anything. fundamentally, you're watching things at the speed you know the Japanese audience would watch it.
Well, that's fine, but you're dealt with the subtitles, or should not with subtitles. Sorry, with the vocal stuff that you do over a Japanese anime. Yeah, fine, you are having to cram all that in because you are trying to keep up with the movie.
And everything sounds like Dog Tanyan and the Four Musket Hounds as well.
Exactly. So he's like, I'm going to do this, mate. Ha! You know, that sort of thing.
No,
In a live action one, though, if you did do the live action version, you could take your time with it. That's it. You're not trying to keep up with the Japanese images that are on screen. You run at your own pace. And I think as long as you get the point across, and like I say, it's well acted, it's given the respect it's due, you remove the shoutiness, you know, from it. Don't have them shouting at inappropriate times at one another and just have them actually acting, you know. Doing that, I think, you know, I personally think, you know, it's like anything, really. You've just got to get the right mix.
Fair enough.
It's like adapting any book.
Yeah.
Or any other thing, you know.
Okay. Well, obviously there's a bit of a debate. Thank you very much for that, Sean.
Yes, indeed.
We had a nice bit of debate out of that. We had a mass debate.
Everybody joined in.
And
soggy biscuit
yeah. And we won't go on about the ending because I think you were almost there with the interpretation of how that ending happened, what's going on with that. But perhaps maybe what we'll do is answers on the postcard, please, and the nearest to the actual comic book answer will win a kudos point, which is redeemable for absolutely nothing. Okay, well, that just leaves us to have the last bit of feedback of the day. And it's got to come from our tame feedbacker. Some say that he has Cthulhu as a garden gnome in his back garden. Other people say that all of his books are actually keeping the earth balanced. All that we know is he's called Jim Moon.
Now, when I first saw Akira back in the day, it completely blew my mind. I wasn't entirely sure I'd grasped all the storyline, but what the hell? Just look at everything exploding and going mental. This was a cartoon film unlike any other I'd seen. And over the next few years, I enjoyed watching it several times more and gradually being able to piece together the strands of plot scattered like shrapnel between the aforementioned everything blowing up and going mental. Unlike many of that generation, it didn't engender in me a love of manga and anime. I did check out some other titles, but I found they were either A, grossly disturbing, Legend of the Overfiend, or, well, just a bit shite in comparison with Akira. And I stress, that isn't a judgment on the state of anime in any way, shape or form. Rather, it's a testament to how bloody good Akira was. However, it has been many a long year since I've seen Akira. In honesty, I don't think I've actually watched it this century. Largely because during the 90s, having discovered it, it was one of those films you just had to show other people. And so, having seen it a great many times in a relatively short span of years, I put it on the shelf and gave it a bit of a rest. A rest that was to continue until Winston decreed it was to be our film of the week. So, what did I think of it this time? Well, obviously, it's still a groundbreaking piece of animation. However, it doesn't look as impressive as it used to back in the day. Partly that's because in this modern world of gigantic high-def tellies, old-school animation done in the 20th century, be it traditional cel animation, stop-motion, or even digital effects, do tend to look, well, a bit bobbins on our fancy new pin-sharp crikey vision screens. But hey, that's par for the course, and the film still impresses with the scale and breadth of its ambition. However, this time round, where it began to falter was the fact that, well, that plot that seemed so enigmatic and intriguing, now I actually know pretty well what is going on in it, I did find rather drawn out and tedious. Now, I do appreciate that an awful lot of plotting and character was lost in compressing the gigantic graphic novel saga into this movie, but even so, I couldn't help feeling that Akira is at its best when you go into it and you don't know what's going on, where you've got the thrill of piecing it together and wondering what the fuck is all this about to carry you through. However, when you do know what it's about, it just seems, well, a lot of things blowing up and a lot of characters shouting each other's name, and you can't help feeling that this could have been perhaps a bit better structured. I think the first half still works pretty well, but in the second half it seems to lose focus and can't quite keep up the momentum. Admittedly, it pulls out all the stops for the big climax at the stadium, when Tetsuo mutates into that giant bubblegum cybernetic monster, and at last the rest of his body is in proportion with his forehead. But by then it's just all a bit too confusing to be satisfying. And maybe it's because I'm getting old. No, strike that, I am getting old, there's no maybe involved. But by the end, I was feeling overwhelmed, but in a rather different way to how the film overwhelmed me when I saw it in my 20s. In my 20s, that climax was truly mind-blowing. Watching it just now, it was making me feel dizzy and nauseous. But on balance, I would say that all my gripes with this current viewing are the result of going back to a film that I know very, very well. The VHS copy in our house looked like absolute arse from the amount of late-night screenings it had had. And I think if you're coming fresh to Akira, it'll still probably blow your mind. Although I dare say, considering how pop culture has moved on, it probably wouldn't be quite as stunning as when I first saw it at the dawn of the 90s.
Right, thank you very much for that, Jim. Sounds like it's all kind of the shine's worn off. And you know what? That's fine. You know, sometimes that happens. And it nearly happened to me, as I said earlier. It's kind of like, start watching it and you're kind of like, yeah, there's bits missing here. There's things that should have happened. But, you know, but interesting that he mentioned that, you know, the best way to view it is to not know anything about it, and Sean's reaction kind of bears that out, so that's quite cool. So, all in all, I understand that point of view. I might not agree with it, but I understand it. Thank you very much, Jim, and as I said, you can hear more of Jim on Hypnobobs, which is at hypnogoria.com, geekplanetonline.com, or on iTunes, and leave him a bloody review as well.
Yeah, put one in there.
Anyway. Right, okay, well, that's pretty much wrapped it up. Now we're sitting at around about the 2 hour 40 minute mark.
Is it? Blimey.
Yeah, it's that fucking Batman-Superman conversation,
it
man.
It caused an awful lot of talk, yes.
But we got to wrap it up, and now it's time to talk about our next film. Our next film is... fucking shit. I think it's probably the best way of putting it. It killed Raul Julia. It was that bad.
Oh, it, man.
It ensured that we wouldn't see Kylie Minogue on the cinema screen for at least another 15 years before when she turned up as an absinthe fairy. It made... well, it didn't do anything to Jean-Claude Van Damme's career, but then
no,
there's not a lot that could, really.
It, unless that is, you mean just adding more fuel to the rocket booster that was firing him towards the depths of hell.
And so it was one of the first film game adaptations. Not the first, mind you. That was, I think, Mario, Super Mario Land, which was bloody awful and all. But here we are in video game land again to watch Street Fighter the movie.
Oh,
and
God.
Before anyone jumps in... no, we're not looking at the anime. No, we are not talking about some obscure other movie. We're talking about the Jean-Claude Van Damme, Kylie Minogue, random characters, Raul Julia, disaster flick in all the wrong ways. Darren, have you ever seen this film before?
Never. I've seen bits of it, and
You've
that was enough.
You've never seen this before?
Yeah, I've seen bits of it, and that was enough.
Okay, my memory of this is I was a big Street Fighter fan, as in the game.
Mm.
Remember I used to have the SNES?
Yeah.
Used to be fucking all over it, could kill a man in like 10 seconds. I was all over it. And then when that came out, I was all over that film. I went to the cinema to watch it, and it was probably the first film I actually considered walking out of in the middle of it.
Was that bad?
It's fucking awful. And I did not see this film again until it appeared on Sci-Fi Channel about 10 years ago. So, my overriding feeling of this film,
yeah,
is that I would much rather try and shit out a pine cone than watch it again. However, apparently we are going to watch it again. So, let's have fun, eh? Let's all keep smiling. Yeah. So, anyway, so if anyone wants to contribute and, put in for a piece of feedback for Street Fighter the movie, the Jean-Claude Van Damme one, not the Kristen Kreuk one.
No.
The Legend of Chun-Li, it's not that one. Then definitely please not. Send your feedback in to blackdog@geekplanetonline.com or leave some feedback on the Facebook group if you prefer.
Or a lighted bag of shit on his doorstep.
Lighted bag of shit on my doorstep. And the Facebook group is, of course, facebook.com/groups/theblackdogpodcast. And that's it, really.
Yes. I want to go to bed now.
You want to go to bed now?
I want to go to bed now.
Okay, fine. Well, I'm going to...
Wrap it up.
And we shall see you all next week for Street Fighter the movie. Take care. See you soon.
Bye.
Now is the time to say goodbye. Now is the time to yield a sigh.
Yield it.
Now is the time to wait.